W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it, watch it, watch it, watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
We got a lot to cover on this Wednesday morning. Some Colts chatter as they get ready for a pivotal divisional game at home with the Titans this Sunday. The Pacers are just a week out from their preseason opener. I think some interesting news on the Myles Turner front that we can get to. And, you know, really big ones this weekend for Indiana and Purdue. Road Big Ten slates, the non-conference portion of the schedule, done for both of those teams. And I think in different ways, big ones for IU and Purdue, at Nebraska and at Minnesota. Jake, do you have your headset?
Eventually, oh, wait a minute. I've got the funky one here. The one that has no ear padding on it. But yes, I do have headsets. Thank you.
When I saw you walk in at like, usually you get here a hair before I do. When I saw you walk in after me, I thought, well, there goes the first 5 minutes of the show.
Well, you know,
first five minutes we spent logging onto the computer, finding the headset. You know, probably, I don't know. Maybe
forgetting to turn the mic on.
Yeah, turning the mic on.
So yesterday, I was downtown, and I noticed that there is a new, all of a sudden, redirection on Capitol. Somewhere around, like, I don't know, like near Methodist. Now you got to wrap around again. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to avoid Capitol this morning. Capitol, I don't know what they're doing. But every day, like the red line apparently is just gone because they're like stripping up the red line. I don't know. So I went down Meridian today, and then the normal little alley I cut across, there was a truck unloading. So it's been one of those mornings where I'm just like,
see, you
locked
gotta
door,
go,
locked door, locked door.
You got to go a couple stoplights further. Meridian to Washington to Illinois.
No, but then you got to go around the circle, and it was all backed up. And
the circle's not backed up.
I'm not going to deal with that. I don't like roundabouts. I was in Carmel yesterday. Enough roundabouts for me.
No roundabouts, no statues.
That's right. So nonetheless, then I ended up in here and now finally found the headsets. But anyway, good morning.
Good morning to you. Good morning, Mark Dykton.
Good morning.
We are now in peak fall season.
It is
the extra layer in the morning, and you probably shed it at some point this afternoon. Again, the Colts get back to practice. Stephen Holder going to join us at 8 o'clock.
You guys have frost on your car this morning?
I did. I park in the garage. The garage is not very insulated. But I didn't notice any frost on cars.
Oh, I did. I was like, no!
Really?
The
frost?
Sign. Yeah.
I didn't have it, thank goodness.
But it is, I mean, it's, you know, 40 degrees in the morning now, and it gets up to, you know, whatever, 65 this afternoon, as the month of October will be here this weekend. Certainly thinking about everybody in Florida, really the entire state of Florida, but especially that Tampa region. Jake, when I think of hurricanes and tropical storms, I don't think of Tampa.
Totally agree. And I was talking to my cousin about this, who lives in Tampa and works for the state health department. So she's hunkered down inside one of the shelters, working as one of the people helping people out. And I mean, I can tell, look, Val's lived in Florida her whole life. I could tell yesterday she was genuinely scared, probably is the right word, but it's now a Category 4. Now, my understanding is they think it's going to hit landfall further south than Tampa now, right?
I thought I heard a little south, a little east of where they maybe originally thought, which would be, you know, good is not the right word to use, but
yeah, no matter what area. Although it seems like to me, to your point, Kevin, and I listen, folks, I don't want to by any stretch of the imagination pretend that I'm like either a meteorologist or an expert on things like hurricanes, but it does seem like Tampa seemingly is less equipped for a hurricane than, say, like Miami would be.
I thought I read somewhere where it's been like a century since the last
101 years, I think, yeah.
Yeah, since the last hurricane there. I don't know if anyone cares about sports-related activities in regards to Hurricane Ian, but we should mention Bucks and Chiefs as of now still on for Sunday Night Football.
That's really hard to believe, isn't it?
I did see they canceled Bruce Arians' Ring of Honor induction
right
for Sunday night, and I believe Tampa is heading to Miami today to practice at the Dolphins facility this week. And the logistics of that work, because Miami is getting on a plane today to come up and take on Cincinnati tomorrow night in Thursday Night Football. So the Dolphins and Jags, they both have road games. Tampa would be the home game. You are starting to see several college games impacted. I saw USF, which plays in the Buck Stadium, South Florida. They are now playing in Boca Raton, so the other side of the state. They're playing at Florida Atlantic. They moved that game with East Carolina over there. And then I saw Florida, which if you look at the path of it, it is kind of Tampa into that Gainesville area. Florida has moved their game to Sunday.
So they pushed it back. It's hard to believe that on Sunday, like let's say that it may, I mean, you're talking a category four here. Could you imagine the New Orleans Saints playing a home game 4 days after Katrina landed?
Well,
I'm not saying
not,
this is
yeah.
Katrina, but I mean, a category four is pretty significant. Now, are you guys both ready to roll your eyes here at 7:06 on a Wednesday?
I'm sure. I've certainly done it earlier.
Let me tell you one thing that surprises me. I'm not saying people will take this as me being, you know, some lefty. That's not the case at all. I'm almost saying this in the absurdity of the world we live in today in certain ways. Like, if this were to actually, and obviously it's not going to, geographically speaking, but if another one of these hits in the Miami area that has the level of devastation, Katrina was historically generational, I get that, but like Andrew or some of the other big hurricanes, if there's one that really does level another round of complete devastation to an area of South Florida, like, are you surprised that the football team still goes by Hurricanes? Like, at some point, doesn't that become like a sensitive word to people there?
Yeah, especially in 2022.
That's what I mean. I'm not saying that they should do that. I'm saying in today's world where we've seen name changes for a lot less.
Yeah, I would say in the 32 years on this earth, of all the thoughts that have crossed my mind, I'm not sure if that's ever crossed my mind.
Right. This is what I'm here for.
And the mascot, it looks like a duck, right?
It's a stork.
Stork?
The corn cob.
No, it's a
pipe.
Crane. It's a crane. Because crane. There is some sort of a significance. Isn't there a significance towards the crane birds? They supposedly are like the one bird that ride out hurricanes and like are usually the first ones seen to like, they take advantage of like fish and whatever else during hurricanes. I kid you not, there is like some significance to a crane bird or whatever that is.
The ibis is what it's apparently.
Is that what kind of bird it is?
Known for bravery as a hurricane approaches.
Yeah.
Wow.
Educate and entertain. 7:07.
Speaking of the university.
The and they smoke pipes.
Yeah.
Speaking of the university.
Fearless.
Ripping a heater while that hurricane approaches.
Of Miami, Stephen Holder, an alum of said university, is going to join us at 8 o'clock. Tony East to talk some Pacers at 8:30, and Dustin Dupirak. We'll get a little IU football flavor today, some Purdue tomorrow. You know, when you look at the rest of IU's schedule, Jake, at Nebraska, I think falls in the category of, if you don't get margin for error to get to six wins, becomes almost zero.
Understood, yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Like, at Nebraska is a game you need.
Did you ever think, Kevin, in your 32 years, two things that I'm going to guess you never thought about in your 32 years of existence. One is the changing of the name Hurricanes, and two is that Indiana would be in a you can't afford to lose a winnable game like this game at Nebraska right. In college football.
I saw yesterday that Nebraska is sold out for Saturday night. You imagine, interim head coach, and you've got that place sold out to welcome the Indiana
Kevin.
Hoosiers to town. And I know what else are you going to do in Lincoln?
This
and
time
they
a
care
year
about
ago.
Football season like none other, but that's just shocking to me.
This time a year ago, Byron and I did our annual road trip, and we did it from Laramie, Wyoming. And we were driving back across. We stayed the night on Friday night, and I don't even remember the name of the town, in far northwestern corner of Nebraska. So we spent the better part of Saturday morning and early afternoon driving across the entire state of Nebraska. Nebraska was hosting Michigan for like a 6 o'clock kick. The entire interstate, the entire way was nothing but cars with, I'm talking from 350 miles out. It was a caravan. It looked like the scene from the movie Hoosiers with the Hickory bus and everybody following it, of people driving to Lincoln to go see Nebraska and Michigan. Crazy.
Just a different animal there. So Indiana, I think a slight underdog last I saw for
no
that
way.
One.
There's no way that they're not favored. Nebraska's terrible.
Mark, will you check that? I thought I saw around 3 points for Indiana as an underdog at Nebraska. I don't think Indiana's very good, Jake.
You don't think so?
No.
Well, he didn't think Cincinnati was very good, and they rolled them.
Very fortunate to be 3-1. I mean, if Florida or if Western Kentucky makes a kick, they lose that game.
I talked to somebody.
Nebraska is now 5.5-point favorites.
I talked to somebody yesterday.
Are we going to be idiots again and
no
take IU to cover?
No.
I talked to somebody yesterday who, I'm not going to say would know. I mean, I talked to somebody yesterday that is pretty tied in with Indiana athletics as an alum that said that they believe that Tom Allen's on a very short leash. And I don't know how, I didn't really dive into how concretely they were going with that as much as like just speculation, but they're like, no, he's probably not the long-term guy. And I said, well, there's a lot of money. Take a lot of money to get rid of him. Get rid of him is the wrong word, but to make a change there. And he said, yeah, I know. I'm just telling you, he's probably not the long-term guy.
Yeah,
he's got the fourth highest buyout in college football.
Right.
I mean, part of me thinks like they would have to lose out for them to view it in such a awful light that they can him here in 2022.
He's got a higher buyout than Ryan Day.
What? That makes zero sense.
That's Indiana for you. That's
higher
Indiana for you.
Higher buyout than Lincoln Riley.
Indiana, I'm telling you right now, if you are a coach and you think there's a chance you got lightning in a bottle, go to Indiana, man. You literally, you're the name, insert name of sport here. You go to Indiana and you have one good year and it's like, oh my goodness, we're going to give you, do you want the Wabash River too? Because we'll give you that too. We cannot, oh, holy cow, we can't lose them.
Yeah, but did they give that to Kevin Wilson?
Kevin Wilson was making decent money, wasn't he? This was more from, don't you remember when they brought out Tom Crean at halftime of a football game with his arm raised like he just defeated Apollo Creed?
Well, certainly different than basketball.
You know?
Purdue at Minnesota.
Minnesota's good, man.
I think 10-point underdog. And the Aiden O'Connell injury, obviously huge. This one for Purdue falls in the category more of, if that Big Ten West hope wants to be alive in late October, early November, this is where you got to steal one. The Penn State game was squandered, and I don't think anyone thought Minnesota would look as good as they've looked. And they have dominated teams. Now, they haven't really played anybody, but they went to East Lansing last week and absolutely blew Michigan State out. So the health of Aiden O'Connell, obviously huge for Purdue. That goes without saying. But a big one for the Boilers this Saturday. I think that is an afternoon game. The wounded Tennessee Titans coming here, Jake.
They are wounded, right? Kind of
very.
Here's another one. I guess we probably knew this was going to be a big one this early, right? But it's pretty big.
Well, it's added to the importance in what you missed out on week one and week two. I would find it very, I think the winner of this division, boil it down to Indy, Jacksonville, Tennessee, I think the winner of this division will have 4 AFC South wins. So you play 6 AFC South games. I think the winner of the AFC South will get 4 of those 6. If you look at the Colts right now, that means they have to run the table in the AFC South. That would be Tennessee here, Tennessee and Nashville coming up in a month. You get Jacksonville in your own building here in a few weeks, and then you close out the season with Houston at home as well. So 3 of your final 4 AFC South games are at home.
Okay, allow me to ask this. We are 3 games into a 17-game slate, right? So you're talking under 20% of the season has been played. With that said, are you ready to say, you're not this year at any point going to say, or you are needing more time to percolate your answer, that the Jacksonville Jaguars are going to be here for the season?
when you say here, do you mean just like in the AFC South mix?
In the hunt, correct.
Because frankly, all you got to do is have a pulse come December and have like six wins and you'll be in the hunt. I do, yeah. I think Jacksonville will be in the mix. How bad are things for the Titans right now? They lost Taylor Lewan, their left tackle for the year. I think last week they have replaced him with the one and only LaRaven Clark.
He's the woodworker, right?
Third round pick of Ryan Grigson back a handful of years ago. Yes, he is a big, I think he built all the furniture in his apartment.
Which is kind of cool.
Very cool. My dad would love that.
It is actually very cool if you are an NFL player that is a handyman with wood and you have a hobby of making furniture and whatnot. It is not very cool if you're an NFL player and virtually every story that's ever been done on you is simply about the fact that you are a woodworker.
Yeah, two things on the LaRaven Clark mention. It's either that from the broadcast crew or it's the Kansas City Chiefs first discovered Patrick Mahomes when watching film of LaRaven Clark.
Right.
Texas Tech teammates. And that was the initial introduction.
And those are kind of the peak of LaRaven Clark, right?
That is. Derrick Henry has had a decent start to the year. Nothing eye-popping. And I would say one thing you got to love if you're a Colts fan is even though the defensive coordinator has changed, Jake, you continue to stop the run at a very, very high level. The best player on this football team through 3 weeks has been Grover Stewart.
Undoubtedly. Undoubtedly. And he's been, I don't know, there were kind of signs of that a year ago, don't you think?
Yes, I would agree with that. But I think he's taking it to another level, Jacob. When we think of defensive tackles, we think of fat dudes that eat up space. Grover Stewart is a great athlete at 315-some pounds. And he is not just in there to eat up space. That dude sheds blocks and lives in the backfield. So when you see the matchup of Henry, you obviously think about your run defense. Tennessee's offensive line is really banged up, and I think Grover Stewart has the ability to just live in the backfield.
By the way, to go back to this real quick, only because I just saw this, the latest model has the hurricane hitting basically right at Fort Myers, but the water surge, instead of the 12 to 16-foot water surge, would go no further north than Sarasota, and Tampa St. Pete would be a 3 to 4 foot water surge. Which, that in itself is, I mean, that's bad news, obviously, for further south, but for the infrastructure of what would be a real challenge in the Tampa St. Pete area, that is probably good news.
Especially from just how equipped are you to handle that. Like we talked about earlier, it's been
Tennessee's injuries, Kevin, are they such that, recap for me real quick, how many of these are like season-ending injuries, or are they simply going through a spell right now that they've kind of got to work through and then they'll be okay?
Yeah, Harold Landry, Taylor Lewan, their best pass rusher and their left tackle, done for the year. We saw Tennessee overcome injuries last year, but man, it just seems like they are, when you look at like their roster and you look at what they've done this season, I don't see a ton of firepower.
Let me read you a text that I just received that I personally think is pretty on point. Jake, you can blame the offensive line all you want, but if you don't get better play from the quarterback position and stop protecting him by blaming it on everyone else, you're not going to make it to week 17. You will not win the AFC South. You might as well get ready to draft a young athletic quarterback like the rest of the league is doing if you want to succeed. Thoughts?
Well, that last point, I don't care if the Colts go 15-2. They should still look for a, and I know they obviously can't, they still should look for a young quarterback. Like, that to me is a that you've kicked the can down the road way too long. That's a must every offseason. I said it yesterday, Jake, if this keeps up, Nick Foles will start multiple games for the Colts this season. And when I say the blame on the offensive line, we'll talk about this with Stephen Holder, to me, the biggest part of that blame is communication.
Yeah. Fair.
So that's Matt Ryan. That's Ryan Kelly. You know, I think some of it, honestly, Jake, it's a little bit of Jonathan Taylor. I know one of the highlights, and I say highlight, it's probably a low light if you're a Colts fan. Remember the play on Sunday when that blitzer comes right up the A gap, right through the middle of the offensive line. Ryan Kelly helps out on Danny Pinter, and no one picks up, I believe it was Nick Bolton for the Chiefs, right. And he just smokes Ryan. Ryan Kelly is helping out Danny Pinter because Chris Jones is opposite Danny Pinter. Clearly, the Colts had a game plan to try at times and help out Pinter. That makes total sense. To me, that is Jonathan Taylor missing that blitz pickup.
That was one of the we have had or seen running backs come through here that were outstanding at picking up blitzes. That's one of those unheralded and never thanked, redundant, I realize, like skill sets. You know what I mean?
Right.
A running back that's really good at picking up blitzes and not afraid to do so.
Yeah, the willingness. Notices.
Correct.
The willingness to do that. So I think it's a communication thing. Matt Ryan making sure everybody's on the same page. That, to me, is the biggest root. Sure, you have individual breakdowns, but that is the biggest one. Did you see Jim Irsay's tweet about Grover Stewart?
I did not, actually. No. About the food?
Yeah, about the wings.
Yes. Food truck, right?
Oh, I didn't see food truck. I saw it's going to be available inside the building on Sunday.
Oh, that's what it was.
For those attending the game on Sunday, you want Grover Stewart's kitchen sink wings. How great is that? From Hard Knocks last year, of course.
Now, does that mean that, is that a double entendre? Meaning that, like, they're prepared in the kitchen sink, but also because, like, he puts everything but the kitchen sink on them to prepare them?
I would have to clarify with the owner, but I think it's just the first part of what you were saying there. Available outside of sections 118 and 510, you've got some portable food stations on Sunday for Grover Stewart. And Irsay, I believe, referred to Chef Adam. Not familiar with Chef Adam, but Chef Adam and Grover Stewart have collaborated on some kitchen sink wings. So I feel like after every Grover Stewart tackle, you just head out to section 118 or 510 and you just load up on the wings.
Now, Chef Adam, let me look this up. I could be wrong in this, and that happened once. In 1979, once I was wrong about something. So it is possible that we are about to have this for a second time. But what is the name of the chef locally that puts together, like for Bullseye Event Group, they've got a chef out there, it's going to drive me nuts, that is like award-winning chef. It's got to be who it is, right?
I don't know. Is this like a Chef Adam, more of a wing specialist?
Well, when it comes to football, Chef Aaron May. Close. That was Bullseye Event Group. Chef Aaron May is superior to Chef Adam.
Xavier Rhodes to the Bills?
Is it Xavier or Xavier?
I thought it was Xavier.
I think it's Xavier.
Now watch, does that mean that Xavier Rhodes is going to go there and suddenly become a great player again? I mean, he was, but he fell off.
I thought he had a really nice first year here in Indy.
Unlike Vontae Davis. Where was Vontae Davis when he quit at halftime?
I think it was Buffalo.
Yeah. Didn't he just at halftime say, that's it, man, I'm done?
Yeah. A little different fashion than I think Antonio Brown did leaving the field, but yeah, that was Vontae Davis. This is something you see, Jake, though. These veterans that sit out, start the year, some injuries happen, Super Bowl hungry teams have a position of need, and boom, Xavier Rhodes reconnected with Leslie Frazier, who they had some history together in Minnesota. So I'm curious to see how Rhodes does.
And Rodrigo Blankenship working out with the Jaguars.
And the Jags kicker is young, but he's kicked pretty well this year, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So this was not like a Tuesday tryout workout.
Yeah, not an injury-related thing, I don't think, at least.
Now, the Chiefs are looking for a kicker, right?
They should be.
But well, is Bucker back? I don't know what his ankle injury is.
They released him, the guy that was...
They released Amendola.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. They said, here's the Megabus ticket. Enjoy the ride to Kansas City.
Now, that Megabus, the cost depends upon when you buy it, right?
I've never done it, but some people that have done it, I think that is true.
So, like, if you're the first guy to buy the ticket, it's $1. Second guy's $2. Third guy's $3. And that's how it originally...
Really? Is that how
it
is?
I have no idea. Is that how that works?
That's how it was in the very beginning. That might have been a promotional thing. So I would think that this poor kicker, his ticket had to have been like $45-$50 because it was the end of the week, right? He's in the very back.
Do you think Kansas City just said, we'll take care of that? Or do you think they were like, hey, man, we'll take that out of your game check after that performance?
Probably the latter, right?
We'll get into some Pacers conversation today. Bob Kravitz wrote something yesterday, and basically, to summarize it, Bob would not be shocked if Myles Turner was traded by 8 a.m. this morning.
I love Bob, but I will respectfully disagree with him on that.
I was going to say, I feel like you've been a little bit more on the Turner can and might be a piece of the future. Bob is definitely on the other side of that. So I want to get into that conversation today. Stephen Holder, 8 o'clock. Tony East at 8:30. Dustin Dopierak at 9. I guess quickly before we hit a break, Jake, anything stand out to you about the IndyCar schedule release yesterday?
No big surprises. I mean, pretty much status quo, right? Obviously, Detroit is a new circuit, so instead of Belle Isle, it's through the streets of Detroit. But other than that, pretty much the same as this year.
How do you get off week one of the NFL? Can't you end it on, like, the Saturday before? I'm thinking, what if you led into Notre Dame or followed Notre Dame on that Saturday in September?
No disagreement. It's really hard to contend with the NFL.
Yeah, that's my one gripe with the schedule. Looks like a nice start to this Wednesday morning. Another cool fall morning. I think temperature should rise into the 60s today. Kevin Vo and Jake Query, Mark Dykton right here, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Into the end zone, and it's caught! Touchdown!
Suddenly, things are looking up. That was a good way of getting the bitter taste of defeat out of our mouths. Now things really start to matter as divisional rival Tennessee makes their way up 65 to Lucas Oil Stadium in a clash of two teams who picked up their first wins. Coverage starts Sunday morning at 9 a.m. with JMV. Kickoff at 1 with Matt Taylor. On your home for Colts football, 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
It'll be first and goal.
Invisible Fence Brand's exclusive technologies make their containment systems the most advanced on the market, giving your pet freedom and you confidence in their safety. Visit InvisibleFence.com to schedule your free consultation.
Ball State football is back in Muncie this Saturday as the Cards take on Northern Illinois at 2 p.m. Secure tickets at BallStateSports.com or charge by phone 888-BSU-TICKET. Chirp, chirp.
Take the next step in your construction career by becoming a union carpenter.
Some of the best pay in the industry.
Amazing health and retirement benefits.
Ongoing cutting-edge training.
Creating my own career path so I can do what I love.
High safety standards.
Great employment opportunities.
Why will you join the Carpenters Union? Join the 75,000 men and women in Indiana who build our communities. For more information, visit the Construction Industry Partnership at IndianaCIP.com.
Hey there, it's Jake Query for Bullseye Event Group. Colts VIP tailgate at bullseyeeventgroup.com is where you can buy your tickets. The ultimate tailgate experience all season long. If you're a diehard Colts fan, even a casual Colts fan, and you want the luxurious tailgating experience, you'll want to check out the very own VIP, your very own game day experience. VIP Colts game day experience located at the Bullseye Event Group directly across from Lucas Oil Stadium. You're talking about fabulous food. You're talking about drinks. You're talking about music. You're talking about JMV broadcasting and Colts fans galore, all experiencing the same VIP tailgate at the Bullseye Event Group Center. BullseyeEventGroup.com is your one-stop shopping for not only Colts tickets, but the Colts VIP tailgate experience and all your entertainment needs. That's BullseyeEventGroup.com. Jake, the website one more time, please. I'm in my car. No problem. BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Nothing hits harder than this. Five-finger death punch.
Under and over.
This Saturday, Ruoff Music Center. With Megadeth. And special guests, The Who. And Fire from the Gods. On sale now at LiveNation.com. Part of the Coors Light concert series. New single, Afterlife, out now.
Hi, this is Jiffy Lube owner Steve Sanner. At Jiffy Lube, we are proud to support Hoosier Charities and the volunteers who use their vehicles to do more to make Indiana a better place to live. In the past year, we've had the honor of recognizing many fellow Hoosiers who go above and beyond. Do you know someone who volunteers their time at a local animal shelter or leads a park cleanup or delivers meals to those who need a little extra help? If so, nominate them for the Jiffy Lube Do More program at JiffyLubeIndiana.com. Jiffy Lube of Indiana provides all of our Do More winners with free vehicle maintenance for a year. Because at Jiffy Lube, our trained technicians do more to keep your vehicle on the road. Brakes, tires, batteries, and more. Plus, we've been Indiana's favorite locally owned oil change since 1985. So visit JiffyLube.com, do more, to nominate someone in your community. That's JiffyLube.com, do more.
Start a new career with a job that keeps your community safe. The Marion County Sheriff, Carrie Forrestal, is hiring detention deputies to work in the brand new Community Justice Center. You'll supervise and guard offenders, making Marion County a better place to live. Starting pay begins at around $40,000 a year with a $5,000 signing bonus. Enjoy great benefits like complete health coverage and pension plan. Start your career as a detention deputy and earn the respect of your community. Apply today at joinmcso.indy.gov.
The Morning Checkdown. Brought to you by Ball State Football. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com. Omaha! On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
What are we at? Seven games now for Aaron Judge without a home run? I think it's seven in a row.
Is he stuck on 60?
Walked four times last night. Can we get to a point where you got to pitch to him? Selfishly?
Listen, here's the thing that's peculiar about that. You know, he was walked, you're right, but Toronto's trying to, you know, Toronto's trying to cement themselves a playoff seed, right? Like, I mean, it'd be one thing if they went in and they're playing, you know, Miami, but, or, you know, I'm trying to think of some, the Reds, but I mean, Toronto's, you know, that listen, they're trying to get some stuff done here, right?
Got five of the six divisions clinched right now in Major League Baseball. Mets and Braves tied in the NL East. Both those teams will be in the playoffs, just got to decide who's going to win that division there. The wild card spots, Blue Jays, Rays, and Mariners in the AL, and then the NL, Braves or Mets, Padres and Phillies. The Brewers are probably the closest team in either division
now,
pushing for
allow me to ask this. What happens if Toronto gets into the play? Don't you have to be vaccinated to enter the state of Canada? Or, I mean, the country of Canada? And aren't there a bunch of...
that was an issue with the Royals when they went to...
Right.
They had like,
so like, Red Sox, and they have a bunch of issues.
Yeah.
So are there some teams that are going to be in the playoffs that might be limited?
Yeah, to be honest, Jake, I do not pay that close
Toronto?
Attention to baseball to know that.
Yeah,
but
I mean, that's fair.
You are a Reds fan. It makes sense.
Okay. Nothing like the Cubs fan. Just with, you know, that type of slander with that.
Yeah, the red hot Cubs, mm-hmm. right? How are those Cardinals doing there, Mark?
Oh, they're still at the top.
Mr. Anti-Cub? Okay.
Anti-Cardinal, I mean. College football this weekend, again, Indiana, Mark said it, 5.5-point underdog with Nebraska. That is a 7:30 kick on Saturday night. Purdue has got Minnesota on the road at noon. Minnesota's played four games this year. They've won by 38, 52, 42, and 27.
Is that good?
Is that good, he says. Listen.
And then the Aiden O'Connell injury, obviously, is monumental for Purdue.
Minnesota's rowing the boat, right? Wasn't that what they did at Western Michigan under P.J. Fleck? And now, you know, a lot of people started to whisper that maybe Minnesota made a bad hire, and here we go. I mean, this is where there are a lot of people that think that Minnesota is the front runner in the West, Big Ten West, right? We'll see what happens. Pacers yesterday, Kevin, getting things underway in terms of their first official practice. It was a short practice, about 90 minutes or so yesterday to get things underway. But then afterwards, Rick Carlisle was talking, Kevin, about his team, right?
Yeah, and here was Carlisle yesterday emphasizing the area of the game last season that the Pacers struggled mightily in.
It's going to start with basics, which is closing out and guarding the ball. And trying as best we can to create a situation where we have as many guys as possible that can guard their man. You know, we want to be a team that can stay out of rotation. Rotation is something that you need when people get beat, and it is the NBA, and there are great players, so people are going to get beat. But we want to build great individual defensive habits, and from there, you know, we have a system when people get beat.
By the way, apparently somebody points out to me, thank you so much, Canada is lifting their vaccination requirement for entry on September 30th. So it would not be an issue for the playoffs.
Gotcha.
In terms of the Pacers, Kevin, we'll get more into this in just a little bit. But I'm actually, you and I have talked about it. Are they going to win a lot of games? Probably not. But there is a level of optimism. Probably intrigue is a better word, right?
Yeah. Intrigue, curiosity. I think it's an exciting time. I know wins and losses will not be at the forefront of how we look at this season, but I will say this, hammer the over on wins. There's no way they lose less than 25 games. No way.
Say that one more time.
They will hammer the over on wins. 25.5?
Yeah, I would tend to agree with you. You have to try, although...
But the Pacers are going to try in the sense of they've got young guys that are trying to establish themselves in the NBA. I don't see the Pacers tanking with really, really bad players. Like last year, Jake, Kiefer Sykes was getting 30 minutes a game at some nights. That's not going to happen this season.
Yeah. Fair. There is a guy that is going to be in this year's upcoming draft that may be the most highly sought after, intrigued prospect since LeBron James.
Webinyama? Am I saying that right?
Sure. He's French, right? He's like a 7'4 French guard.
We'll get into the Pacers conversation again. Jake, a little bit more in the thinks Myles Turner could be here long term. Bob Kravitz not in that camp. We'll bring you that discussion. And yesterday, it was not the starting lineup, according to Rick Carlisle, who got the best on the practice floor. It was the second unit. We'll explain who was a part of that second unit. And we'll continue the Colts conversation with a big one on Sunday with the Tennessee Titans. We'll do that coming up next here. Kevin Aquari, 93.5 107.5, The Fan.
Join me today. Lots going on. Pacers start a practice. College basketball start a practice. And, of course, the Colts and the Titans in a monster game. Join me today, noon to 3. Let's talk about all of it.
As a roofer, every second counts. Late deliveries and incomplete orders cost me time and money. That's why I partner with Beacon. Beacon's unique network of branches work together to get me what I need when I need it. Every branch working together. With Beacon, I know my supplies will be delivered on time and complete. Homeowners rely on me, so I rely on Beacon, because I never stop building, and neither do they. Go to BECN.com to get started building with Beacon. Beacon, always building.
Hi, it's Bob from Royal Spa. Soaking in a hot tub full of Epsom salts is the absolute best way to minimize everyday aches and pains. And we know all about Epsom salts at Royal Spa. Royal Spa hot tubs are the only hot tubs on the market that can safely and effectively use Epsom salts. Made right here in Indiana, Royal Spa hot tubs are the highest quality hot tubs on the market. Visit any one of our three Indianapolis locations or visit royalspa.com.
Ah, Royal Spa.
Hi, I'm Ryan Kelly with thehomeloanexpert.com. Not only do we have lower rates, but with our Lock and Shop program, we can lock you in at the perfect time and protect that rate for up to a year while you search for your dream home. Then in the future, if rates come down, with a simple refinance, we can lower that monthly payment. Everything starts today at thehomeloanexpert.com. Home in the 10-day closing guarantee.
The Home Loan Expert LLC, NMLS number 1326241.
What QC Kinetics is doing for people here is nothing short of amazing. I'm talking about real lasting relief from joint pain. I'm Kevin Bowen, and you guys have heard QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in exciting new pain treatments with advanced regenerative medicine, non-surgical alternatives. If you're living with joint pain from injury or arthritis, don't let them tell you that steroids or pain meds or surgery are your only options. QC Kinetics uses regenerative treatments that can restore and repair damaged tissue. Maybe you've been diagnosed with bone-on-bone arthritis and been told you need a replacement. Call QC Kinetics now for an alternative way to deal with the pain. These amazing protocols work with pain caused by injury as well, like a torn meniscus or rotator cuff. So call QC Kinetics now and don't keep living with that pain. Call QC Kinetics for a free consultation. 463-235-7160. Locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. QC Kinetics. 463-235-7160.
Helzberg Diamonds presents the guy who hit a home run with an engagement ring. Andy was on a mission to find the perfect engagement ring. But where to start? He did research, went online, asked his best friend for advice.
Hey, for engagement rings, where should I...
Helzberg!
Andy went to Helzberg Diamonds. At Helzberg, Andy found an incredible selection of lab-grown and natural diamonds, certified and guaranteed to be of the highest quality. He also found help choosing a custom setting from Julie, a Helzberg diamond expert.
Don't worry, we got this.
Plus, he learned about Helzberg's special financing options, so Andy could get the perfect ring for her with a payment plan that was perfect for him. And when it was time to propose, he got the reaction he wanted.
Wow, you really hit it out of the park, babe.
Mission accomplished. Be like Andy. Find the ring of her dreams at a Helzberg store near you or at Helzberg.com. And right now, take advantage of special financing offers. Hurry, offer ends soon.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in plumbing. That's Lance and his local team at LD Smith Plumbing. 317-284-9526. Let's talk about 83 of free involving any drain in your home. Means LD Smith is going to come out, make sure your drains are clogged free for $83, or the visit is free. That's 83 of free at 317-284-9526. The best in plumbing, Lance and his local team online, ldsmithplumbing.com.
Previously on Kevin and Query.
I would consider Tiger Woods my idol. I've never met Tiger. I've thought about meeting him.
Did you like that?
Yes.
Yeah, I did too. That was awesome.
And I've thought to myself, as soon as I say hello, I'll probably say, I'm sorry, my hands are so sweaty and I'm so nervous and I'm stuttering and I can't believe that I'm meeting you right now.
Take it easy, champ. Why don't you stop talking for a while?
God, Tiger!
I want to kiss you.
What do you mean?
Can I express some fandom?
Well, it was in the middle of the Jelani Woods interview, and we went on this like 30-second tangent about how you're like fanboying over Tiger Woods.
Yeah, it felt like it was...
Jelani did not know how to respond to that. He's like, oh, okay.
I thought he responded very well.
Jelani actually agreed with Kevin, because Jelani apparently had the same fascination with Matt Ryan and was like, yeah, I get it.
It is kind of a wild story.
Have I told you? What's that?
I mean, you know, you're growing up in the backyard and you're literally mimicking Matt Ryan, and then here you are, not as a quarterback, but now you're catching a game-winning touchdown pass for Matt Ryan?
It would be like, yeah, I guess it would be like me playing in the same backcourt with Jay Edwards or Reggie Miller as a pro. That would have been unique. I've told you the one athlete, Kevin, one, and I've been very fortunate in my career. I'm just old. I've been around a long time. To have crossed paths with, interviewed, or covered games of a lot of great athletes, because I've covered a lot of, you know, different sports, but in different capacities. The one athlete that left me completely starstruck, the only one where I was like, oh my gosh.
Joey Chestnut.
I'm seeing him in the flesh. How'd you know? No. Bo Jackson. Bo Jackson is the one.
Makes
that
sense.
Was my Tiger Woods, because that was in my absolute zenith of sports fandom, impressionable age, and he was a mythical figure. And then I saw him in person and was like, holy cow. By the way, good morning to you. It is a Wednesday. It is Kevin and Query. That's Kevin Bowen. I'm Jake Query. Mark Dykton here as well. Good-looking day. Start to the day. And yesterday, practice number one now in the books for the Pacers. This is not to say, Kevin, that I think that Myles Turner is going to be a long-term player with the Indiana Pacers. However, I do believe, and I may be proven completely wrong here, but my educated opinion on it, not to say that Bob Kravitz is uneducated. I love Bob Kravitz, and I think he's one of the most dialed-in people in this town. Educated guess is a better way of saying it. My educated guess is that Myles Turner is on the roster up to the trade deadline, and then all bets are off. But I think he will start this season on the roster. Now, and I think that the Pacers are going in thinking that. But I also think that if someone were to come along and make a can't-miss offer for Myles Turner, the Pacers would indeed make that move. But if that were going to happen, it would have happened by now.
Now, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I feel like in the last, I don't know, a couple of weeks that this conversation's been brought up, you have felt like a Turner-Pacers relationship could continue after this season.
I would agree with that as well.
Do you feel that?
Yes.
This is Bob Kravitz yesterday. This much we know to be true. Turner's days in Indiana are numbered, which is both mildly sad and perfectly understandable. He needs, wants out, and Indiana's moving in a different direction. Everybody's on the same page. He'll be a free agent at season's end, and he's not staying in Indiana, his home for the past 7 years. There's no black hat or white hat here, not like there was with Paul George or Victor Oladipo. Turner gave the Pacers 7 good years, and at this point, headed into his 8th season, both sides have made it clear the relationship is not going to last.
I think that Myles Turner will be on the roster when they start the season. I could be totally wrong in that. I
guess, to be fair, Bob is... not saying he'll be gone at the start of the season, but he has made it very clear that Myles Turner and the Pacers will not be together this time next year.
Well, that's I can't disagree with that.
If that is true, Jake, they're not going to be here next year. How do you handle Turner this season?
Turner's been in this situation. He knows what's up.
How do the Pacers handle it? I'm not talking about how does Turner, like, I mean, if you're the Pacers and this guy's not going to be here next year, you play him and
you showcase him.
You're
right?
Risking injury. He's injured himself with foot injuries each of the last two seasons. You play him. You're taking minutes away from an Isaiah Jackson. You know, Isaiah's probably the one young guy that I think a lot of people are intrigued by that fits a little bit more of that position. I think people are pretty much done on Goga. Daniel Tice, a little bit more in the veteran route. But I think those would be the questions you have to ask yourself if you're going to play. I expect them to play him and treat him like a normal starter. But how do you not have those questions, though?
I think the thing about Turner that puts you kind of in a rock and a hard place. You have young players, Kevin. The Pacers are, there is no doubt, and I know they're not going to use this terminology, but the Pacers, you know, to be honest with you, I'm not going to say the hardest, the most important. The most important ingredient for the Pacers to understand or buy into a refoundation, we'll say it that way. The most important person to get on board with that was Rick Carlisle. Because the roster, I mean, they can't control what you're going to do. The front office decides what you're going to do. But you have a coach making, what, $7.5, $8 million a year who's won an NBA title that came here, and you have to make sure that he understands, listen, this is not a situation where we're bringing you in to get us over the top. You're just over 60 years old. Are you cool with being on the ground floor on this? And Carlisle was and is. And I think the young players understand that. Turner is an interesting one because he's not a young player. Now, he is young. He's, what, 26? But in NBA years, he's not young. And so how do you showcase what he can do if you are also trying to get Isaiah Jackson minutes, to get younger players minutes, and to also put yourself in position for one more year of the lottery, which is exactly what they're going to do. It's exactly what they're going to do.
Like, how much can Turner really improve his trade stock in the first 3 months of the season?
I would tend to agree with that, and that's why I think the Pacers know, look, he's here, we got to make the most of it. I do think that there are some things he can bring. He's a mature guy, and I think a level, like, this is not...
I just think that's an awkward balance.
It is.
You use the word showcase Turner, and obviously Turner helps you right now in trying to win games, but if you take Bob Kravitz's words and realize that both parties seem to fully acknowledge that a relationship is not going to last past this season, that means Turner has to be traded by February. But if I'm thinking about the long term, and Isaiah Jackson is a guy long term, I want to play Isaiah Jackson a good amount. I don't want Myles Turner to get hurt. I want to make sure that you get, you know, proper value and trade for him. The last thing you want for the Pacers is Myles Turner to suffer another injury like he has each of the last two seasons, and all of a sudden you get the trade deadline and he's lost significant trade value, or you get the free agency next year for some reason and he's still here and he doesn't want to re-sign, and now Myles Turner's walked. And that is a guy that you drafted, invested in for a half dozen years, and got zero on return for him. Those are my concerns with the Turner situation.
All fair, for sure.
Did you see his tweet yesterday?
I did not.
I was curious if this was in reference to Bob's article. Myles Turner fires up this on the Twittersphere. When the hate don't work, they start telling lies. Season. A couple pictures from Media Day around that. I think an 8-ball is what he had. In the tweet, 8-ball emoji. Would that be his eighth? Is it his eighth year?
That may be right. Listen.
Those were in quotes, by the way. When the hate don't work, they start telling lies.
I like Myles Turner, but Myles Turner is a big fan of the cryptic tweets, is he not?
He definitely is.
Mark quietly agrees.
Yep.
He doesn't tweet often, but cryptic tweets and Myles Turner, they go hand in hand. Pacers Steve, your thoughts on Myles Turner?
I was so happy driving to work to hear you bring up rumors of him leaving. I don't understand where Turner fits in anywhere. He's not a Joel Embiid. The league is moving to a heavy outside three-point shooter type game. I think the value of a guy in the paint that's a blocker, and that's his one-trick pony, is being a high on blocks. I think that those kind of guys are diminished. If you do not have Joel Embiid...
He can stretch the floor, though, Steve.
Well, his three-point shooting is no better than a 25 other tall forwards in the league. And this should be somebody that, for his salary and his experience and his height and the position he plays, should be a 20-10 player. He can't rebound. Taylor is a half a foot shorter than Turner and has more rebounds per minute when he's playing than Turner. And
Steve,
Taylor gets down in the paint. You watch Taylor when he's in the paint, and he bullies people out of the way.
Yeah, Taylor can play.
Turner cannot rebound. He is gangly. He's goofy running down the floor. He's got a weird run. He's not made for a high-octane, high-speed offense. He barely does better than the 20-10. This is somebody that he's like a 12-6 player getting $20 million a year. And if you keep him, you've got to sign him to an even bigger contract. And I totally agree. Exactly what's going to happen. If you hang on to him as theoretical showcase and prop up his trade value, he is going to get an injury and be off the trade market. He's very injury prone, which is a whole other reason not to be a fan of him. I think you get rid of him now. If you're building, if you're in a youth movement and you're in a teardown and you want to rebuild this team, Turner has no business on the floor getting minutes. You want Jackson and Smith getting minutes and people like that. Turner absolutely makes no sense in this lineup being in the final year of his contract. His premium trade value is now. If not now, there may be a little bit of logic in letting teams go through the next 3 weeks.
Here's the thing, though, Steve.
And stuff, I hope somebody big gets hurt on another team.
No, Steve, they're all really good points, okay? All really good points. I appreciate it. But
thank you for the passion, Steve.
Excellent points. The one issue there is this, and that is, I'm telling you, if Myles Turner had the kind of trade value that could get the Pacers back assets that they could use, he would have been dealt by now. Part of the reason I asked directly, is Myles Turner on the roster? Does that say a little bit about the fact that there was not a market for Myles Turner that got you return on investment if you were to send him out? And the response was indirect, but I've done this a long time. And the response was, he's on our roster, and we reserve the right to say that he won't be forever, but for now, he's on our roster.
Yeah, I think back to the trade deadline last year, Jake, and Turner getting hurt. Was that all of a sudden what led to Domantas Sabonis trades being explored, therefore Sacramento Kings having some interest, therefore Tyrese Halliburton being here? Just kind of wild to think back on that, how that Turner injury had a domino effect that could have led to Halliburton now being here.
Right.
The trade rumor that has been most often mentioned as of late with Turner is that Lakers trade for a 2027 first-round pick. It doesn't sound like the Lakers want to add in the 2029 first-round pick. I want draft picks, but I also want assets that are going to help you out right now. Like, you have this young timetable, this young core. Could you move those draft picks, and package them in other deals? Sure. But I want to make sure that I'm trying to help Tyrese Halliburton, Benedict Mathurin, Isaiah Jackson, Chris Duarte, whoever else you want to throw into that young core, Jalen Smith. I want to help them out now. So that one I don't like. Yesterday, Rick Carlisle mentioned that the second unit of TJ McConnell, Benedict Mathurin, Aaron Nesmith, Terry Taylor, Isaiah Jackson, he called them dominant on day one. So that second unit, I would assume, was playing against the starting group of Turner, Jalen Smith, Chris Duarte, Buddy Hield, and Tyrese Halliburton.
I'm telling you, I like Terry Taylor. I don't know. I mean, he's a deep rotation guy, but I like what he brings to the table. I think they like what he brings to the table because he plays way bigger than he is.
How did he not lead a mid-major team on some NCAA tournament run?
It's a great question.
Doesn't he just look like that guy?
Totally.
We'll get in some Colts conversation next. Stephen Holder from ESPN.com joins us.
The weather is getting cooler. The sunset's spectacular. This is when Friday Night Football shines. Two perennial 6A powerhouses look to establish their dominance. The Brownsburg Bulldogs travel to Zionsville to do battle with the Eagles. It's a Hoosier Crossroads Conference showdown under the Friday Night Lights. Brought to you by CarX. Don't worry, call the CarX team. Brendan King has the kickoff. Friday at 7 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
The best audio entertainment this fall is on Audible. It's the home of storytelling with audiobooks, exclusive originals, popular podcasts, and more. All in one app. Sign up for a free 30-day trial at audible.com.
It's JMV for the 14 Central Indiana CarX locations. There's one near you. You can check out the full service auto repair specialist and, of course, the JMV specials online now. CarX.com.
Hey, Indianapolis. I'm Scott McCauley, the voice of the Marion University Knights football program. The Knights are on a roll and undefeated at home, and tickets are on sale now for this weekend's homecoming game. Get your tickets now for this Saturday's in-state contest as Marion hosts Taylor at 1:05 p.m. at St. Vincent Field. We can't wait to see our alumni and Marion families this weekend. Buy your tickets now at munights.com and click the tickets link. Pricing starts at $10.
Nothing hits harder than this. Five-finger death punch. This Saturday, Ruoff Music Center. With Megadeth. And special guests, The Who. And Fire from the Gods. On sale now at LiveNation.com. Part of the Coors Light concert series. New single, Afterlife, out now.
Hi, I'm Ryan Kelly with TheHomeLoanExpert.com. The days of multiple offers are behind us, and it's officially a buyer's market. And although interest rates are a little higher than they were this time last year, the lower sale price should more than make up for it. And when rates do come back down, we can always do a simple refinance to lower your monthly payment. Marry the house, date the rate. TheHomeLoanExpert.com, home of the 10-day closing guarantee.
The Home Loan Expert LLC, NMLS number 1326241.
It's JMV for Indiana's Best. My friend Eric Wilson and Andy Moore Buick GMC, 131st and State Road 37. It's in Fishers. Check it out right now. The GMC Acadia, good for you, the family, and the friends of the family. Inventory, car buying experience, service after the sale, the absolute best. It's one-stop shopping. Ask for Eric Wilson and head to Andy Moore Buick GMC. 131st and State Road 37 in Fishers.
Turn a loss into a win with the King of Sportsbooks. Place a one-game parlay wager with at least four legs on any Major League Baseball game. If all the legs of the parlay hit but one, you'll get your stake back in free bets up to $25. Log into your account or download the app and sign up with BetMGM to take advantage of this offer. Just opt into the one-game parlay insurance promotion, then place a one-game parlay wager with four legs or more on any MLB game. If you miss only one leg on your wager, you'll receive up to $25 back in free bets. Major League Baseball trademarks used with permission. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. Must be 21 years or older to wager. Indiana only, new and existing customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Denny Smith for Sundown Gardens. The big fall sales here at Sundown Gardens. 20% off container trees and shrubs, 30% off bald and burlapped evergreen and shade trees, 30% off perennials, and 50% off on Japanese maples. Hurry in for the best selection. Fall's a fantastic time to plant, so follow Sundown Gardens on Facebook and Instagram and make a plan to come visit this week. 186th Street and Spring Mill Road, just west of Grand Park, sundowngardens.com. That's sundowngardens.com.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W298BB. WIBC HD3 W228CX, Indianapolis.
American Standards College Football Saturday begins when Iowa hosts Michigan. The coverage begins at 11:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
By the way, Kevin, I did not know this, so I'm filling you in. This from our Ben Davis High School Radio student correspondent, Owen Pulley, who is a proud member of, I believe, WBDG. I think he's the sports director there. That's the Ben Davis High School Radio Station.
I've been a guest a time or two on there. I love it. You know, my dad is thick Ben Davis.
That's right. Roots. And Owen, super talented young guy. Someday probably will have the job that we currently hold. He said, guys, when the hate don't work, they start telling lies. It's from Ball Drop by French Montana. The song references the new year, and when the new year or the new season starts, he just cuts everyone off.
There you go. Thank you for that.
So Owen keeping us hit,
view
man.
On that. I will just sneak this in before we get to Stephen Holder. I love Steve's passion, the call we just had. I would push back on him acting like Turner doesn't have value in the NBA. If you protect the rim and you can stretch the floor at 7 foot, you are going to have a role in the NBA, and teams are going to value you.
That's true, but I think it is more select than probably other positions, right?
We can debate how much value, right. And obviously rebounding is an issue for him, but there is interest in Myles Turner around the league.
Joining us now on the Payless Liquors guest line, as he does seemingly each and every week. Last time it was to mention D.B. Cooper, which took off like wildfire, and everybody now has been tweeting us D.B. Cooper stuff. Stephen Holder is with ESPN.com. He covers the NFL and notably the Indianapolis Colts. He is also a native of South Florida. So, Stephen, let's begin with this. I know that your family is in the Miami area. Fortunately, Miami not necessarily right in the direct line for Hurricane Ian, which now apparently is a Category 4 and could continue to increase by the time it makes landfall on the western side of Florida. But you know, you've been through this, I would assume, or your family has. What is the thought process for you as a Florida native when you see your home state, you know, in peril and preparing for something like this?
Oh, yeah, I've been through it. I think it's very familiar, and you know it's going to come at some point. You know, you have to prepare for just a wide range of outcomes. That's the hard part, you know, because you know it's coming, but I remember Hurricane Andrew, 1992. I think I was maybe a sophomore in high school or something, and that storm initially was heading about to the Dade County and Broward County line, right in that area. Well, I lived right there, and so this thing, and that was a historic storm. This thing is bearing down on us, and then at the last minute, it bumps just a little bit to the south, and it hits south of the city of Miami. The devastation was still just, you know, catastrophic, right? But it didn't hit the primary area of population. So, you know, you can imagine what that would have been. The point is, you just don't know, and you have to basically prepare for that direct hit, you know. And so I did spend 8 years in Tampa, and so the West Coast, this is a little different for them. The West Coast of Tampa, or that particular part of the West Coast, I should say, the Tampa Bay area in particular, hasn't had a direct hit in, like, I think something like 60 or 70 years, which is crazy. And I worry about the Bay. If you've ever been to Tampa or St. Petersburg, you know that the waterfront is everything, right? And there's so much just sort of centered on the waterfront in the Bay, and that water pushing in from the Gulf. And so anyway, I don't want to get into a meteorological report here, but there's a lot to worry about. And yeah, I got my fingers crossed for a lot of people that, you know, I have relationships with. So hoping for the best for them.
Yeah, we took a family vacation to Anna Maria Island, which is out in that area last year. And I'm just picturing beautiful that drive place from the Tampa airport, Stephen. And oh my gosh, you talk about exposed and the water right there. And like you said, that area of Florida is not necessarily used to it, like maybe some other parts are. So thinking about everybody down in your home state. No easy transition here to the Colts, but we'll do that. The Colts and the Titans on Sunday at Lucas Oil Stadium. I would say the biggest Colts-related topic of the week is centered around the pass protection issues. Steven, you know, I think there's a lot that you can put at for some of the issues, individual play, the mishandling of stunts, the communication problems. I'd probably go to that last part, and that's where I think Colts fans have a little bit of, like, glass-half-full optimism. To me, the biggest problem with protection right now revolves communication. And I would like to think that Matt Ryan's 15 years of NFL experience, Ryan Kelly's 7 years of NFL experience, they could get that figured out.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that the unblocked rushers is just completely mystifying to me, right? You know, how is this happening with a veteran center who's been to the Pro Bowl, a quarterback who's been the MVP of the NFL? I mean, of all the concerns we had about Matt Ryan, diagnosing blitzes certainly wasn't one of them, right? And I think the thing that makes this a little more, I guess, hard to stomach is the fact that a lot of these things have not been, you know, sort of brand new exotic blitzes. There have been blitzes that they knew were coming. Certainly, they tried to disguise them. Let's be clear. It's not as if the defenses are just telling you what they're going to do, but they should be able to pick this stuff up. So I really can't put my finger on why it's not happening, but I agree. I think there is justification for a glass half full approach here, because these guys, I do trust them to figure it out. And we've also never seen this from the Colts. You know, they have done a pretty good job of this in the past. It's not something they've struggled with. I do think having new members on that offensive line is, we knew that there could be a downgrade in their performance, perhaps, but I don't think we appreciated the change in continuity and synergy among that unit. Ryan Kelly kept telling me in the locker room last couple of weeks, he said, you know, we're not playing as one. All five guys are not playing as one yet. Why is that not happening yet? I don't know, but I do agree that they can get there. And if they do, that changes the game.
Steven, when you look at the Colts and where they are right now, which of these statements do you think, you know, at Thanksgiving time, we're going to look back on and realize to be more true? A, Kansas City was not near as dominant as we thought, and therefore the Colts defeating them kind of water found its level there? Or B, Jacksonville's a heck of a lot better than we thought, and the Colts getting embarrassed down there was then not as embarrassing in the long run?
Hmm. This is tricky. I actually think that Kansas City, had they eliminated the mistakes on Sunday, Kansas City could have put 40 on the board. Now, I could have said the same thing about the Colts in week one. Kansas City lost that game in much the same way as the Colts ended up with a tie in Houston, if that makes sense. You know, I thought they were much better than what they displayed. The Colts had like 500-plus yards of offense in Houston, right? Kansas City had so many opportunities they just didn't capitalize on, and they just gave so many or made so many mistakes that they enabled the Colts to win that game. So I go back and forth on Jacksonville. I really like what they're doing. And I will answer your question here at some point. I'm rambling. But I think with Jacksonville, we still need to see a little more, you know, because there certainly were, well, beating the Colts is not big news anymore for them, right? And then going to L.A. and beating the Chargers, that was incredibly impressive. However, I do think the Chargers were not themselves, right, for a number of reasons.
Certainly their quarterback wasn't.
Right. So let's see Jacksonville keep it up. Let's see them keep it up. I'm optimistic, though, that they're much better. So I still think that Kansas City is going to be pretty good. I still think they're going to be pretty good, but it is going to be harder. They're having to win in a different way this year. But I lean toward Kansas City being the team we think they are, or at least largely the team that we think they are.
Yeah, I think we probably expect Kansas City to still win the AFC West, but if for some reason they don't, that could be a rematch at Lucas Oil Stadium if the Colts win the AFC South. to open up the wild card round of the playoffs. Stephen Holder from ESPN.com. He's with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Stephen, I know you and I and you know, some of our colleagues, we had a lot of Shaquille Leonard discussion, not only with Frank Reich, but just kind of amongst ourselves on Friday. Jake and I were talking yesterday about it. And I think from day one, it's been a very confusing injury situation. It's been complicated. I mean, Shaq said it in May, I think I'm done with surgeries, procedures, whatever you want to call it. A few weeks later, he's having back surgery. I guess to summarize everything, do you feel like this is where you would put it right now? Shaquille Leonard is not comfortable playing at 80 or 90%. If you had to sum it all up, is that where we're at right now based off the 4 weeks of practice he's had in a row now and how he views himself on tape versus, you know, past years?
Yeah, it sounds like he doesn't feel like himself. And I think that is, I think that's basically the same thing you're saying. And so the question then becomes, you know, how much further does he need to go to get to where he's comfortable? And I do think the one thing that we did learn is that a lot of this is being driven by Shaq and how he feels. And it's still a collaborative decision to borrow the phrase from Frank Reich, but it does seem as though they're listening to Shaq in large part here. And they said, look, he knows his body. And I also think that this has been something he's been dealing with for so long, which goes to the point that you just made, that I actually don't blame him if his approach is that, look, I don't feel like myself just yet. Then it's hard to blame the guy for not going out there and saying, I'm going to play anyway, when he's been dealing with this issue for, according to him, like 3+ years, right? Or some sort of form of lower body pain in some fashion, right? So I get it. And then, so the next couple of weeks are interesting for the Colts too, because I think we can say, without even having seen what happens this week, we can say it's probably going to be a close call again, right? And if he doesn't play on Sunday, then I wonder what's the point of trying to make a go 4 days later in Denver. So there's a 2-week window here where he can really get 2 weeks of work under him, get some rest as well, and be ready to go after that little 10-day break after the Broncos. I don't know that that's how they're going to handle it, but I'm just saying if he doesn't play this week, that's probably where I would come down on it and just try to get through. But, boy, could they use him right now. There's no question. The defense is starting to come around, right? And I think you can
imagine.
Those
turnover numbers are a little quiet for their standard.
That is the thing. That's the thing. This team averaged almost 2 turnovers per game last year. And so to only have a couple now, you know, through 3 games, that's not them. That is not them, and that was not their formula last year.
Stephen, I'm not making light of this at all. I'm simply quoting from the past within the Colts and injury history and the owner. What percent of Shaquille Leonard not being out on the field at this point is between the ears?
Oh, some of it certainly is. What percent? Hard to say. I think it's a decent size percentage.
So that folks listening don't get it confused. That's not me or you saying that it's an intellectual or a like mental health issue as much as just psychologically feeling comfortable and not being hesitant, right, about your body.
Yeah. Yeah, and it stems from something Jim Irsay has said in the past, specifically about Andrew Luck at one point when he was going through some things, rehabbing that shoulder and getting confidence back in it. I think there's nothing wrong with that. I think you just said this, but I'll reinforce it. There's nothing wrong with that because I think it's absolutely true. One of the biggest things when you're coming off a major injury, you know, having surgery or whatever the case might be, is regaining confidence in your body and in your ability to do what it is that you do. You know, what these guys do is hard. Okay. And when you have to do it after having, you know, sort of a major injury, you know, you're asking a lot in terms of from a confidence standpoint, you're asking a lot of them, you know, to go out there and to overcome that. So that's a process. That is a process. And I think the thing you have to understand, particularly when you're dealing with nerve issues and things of that nature, is The big thing that Shaq had to deal with here is regaining his strength in his lower body. I mean, if you talk to people who have had similar issues, they feel they just don't have any strength. You know, and that's one of the issues that he just had to overcome. That was a big part of the late summer process for Shaquille. And so now it's a matter of also getting his legs back and being the player he can be. I'm not surprised in retrospect, now that we know more about it, I'm not surprised that it's taken this long. And then when you factor in, as you just pointed out, the mental aspect of it, that it's understandable that this has been a long process.
Stephen Older from ESPN.com, he's with us here on Kevin and Query. Stephen, through 3 weeks, has there been a better Colt than Grover Stewart?
That guy, let me tell you, I mean, talk about somebody who can maybe ask for a contract renegotiation.
Exactly.
Yeah. Maybe it's him.
Right. Kenny Moore needs to take a look at him and see how he's playing.
Yeah, I'll tell you something. You know, we came into this year thinking this was going to be the year the pass rush really took off. And we did see, I thought, a really impressive pass rush against Kansas City. But you know what's happened? The rush defense, the run defense, I guess, has been spectacular. I mean, there were some – I think if you look at it statistically, maybe it doesn't look amazing. But I think the eye test tells you, right? There have been a couple of long runs that have gotten out maybe the first couple weeks, but they've shut it down. And they have really been in the backfield just consistently. And the guy who's there more than anybody is Grover Stewart. This is and maybe this is one of those things where, you know, we talk about positional value, right? Maybe the nose tackle isn't the most important position, and we hear this a lot with Quentin Nelson and maybe even Jonathan Taylor, right? Today the running back is a little bit de-emphasized. I mean, whatever, right? Whether you agree with those takes or not, that's not the point. The point is, I think if you look across the board, nose tackle is probably not the highest priority on people's list. However, when you talk about disruption on the early downs, what you do is you get exactly what the Colts need for this defense to work properly, which is third and long, second and long, third and long. And he's helping them create more of those. So in that respect, he has a lot of value, and I think it's a great development for the Colts.
Grover Stewart played collegiately at Division II Albany State. I'd like to know, between Mark Dykton, Kevin Bowen, and Stephen Holder, which of you can tell me the mascot of Albany State University?
The kitchen sink wings.
Okay. Mark, your guess?
It's not Pirates, is it? I don't know.
Hey, it's not Pirates.
East Carolina, right, on that?
The Frogs. Yeah, let's go Frogs.
The Frogs.
Yeah, sure, why not?
I remember when they drafted them, I was like, I have never heard of this school.
It's in Albany, Georgia.
I know about it because my wife's family is from that area, but that's literally the only reason. And I think some of their family attended the school. Otherwise, I'd have no concept of that school.
Golden Rams.
Sure.
The Golden Rams. Yeah. So my question is, Stephen, Grover Stewart, was it anticipated when he was drafted as a fourth rounder that he would be a golden defensive tackle, or is this literally the definition of a guy that, you know, in other words, how is a guy like this who has turned out to be, I mean, you know, what you're talking about with him, from a Division II school, is this just late bloomer? Was there something in the past? And did the Colts envision that it would be this good for him the way it's all come together?
Well, I'm glad you asked, because I have done reporting on this in the past and gotten to know Grover Stewart a little bit, but who, by the way, is delightful, okay? Let me tell you, he is, you get the yes, sir, no, sir. Like, yeah, you get that. He is the Southern, you know, the prototypical South Georgia guy. But anyway, he is definitely a late bloomer to some extent, but that's because he was always a project, to be honest. And I think with those guys, it can go either way. Sometimes it works out, sometimes it doesn't. To Grover Stewart's credit, he put in the work to ensure that it worked out. And if you look at Grover Stewart today versus the guy who was drafted, if you look at him physically, he's a different guy. Now, he's still huge and can block out the sun, but he is not the same guy. He's revamped his diet, mm-hmm, and really done a lot of work there. I think he said he dropped like something like 25 pounds or something. Well, that's a lot, even for a big guy. And he worried that maybe he'd lose some of his power. And I don't think that I don't think that turned out to be true. What did turn out to be true, though, is that he discovered just another level of quickness and speed off the line, and that is really what these offensive linemen are struggling to cope with right now. So I think the ability was always there, but I don't know that he always had the same tenacity, and he certainly didn't have the physical part of it. He had to develop that. And so now you've got a really strong guy who has reworked his body and now has limitless confidence because he's out there and he's done it and he's proven it. And, I mean, he's just – good luck to those interior linemen right now because he is just – he's putting up highlight moves on these guys right now.
And I think it was a good point you brought up, Steven. You know, he signed that extension in 2020 and has ascended as a player since then. You don't
I love
often
that.
See that. And the other thing to note is I think he plays a position where guys hit their prime kind of late 20s. I think interior defensive linemen, it is kind of at this age that Grover's starting to enter where he hits his prime. And I noticed, you know, in camp, Gus Bradley, someone asked him, you know, has anybody surprised you? And he mentioned Grover. You know, and I think when you think about defensive tackles, you think of space eaters. You don't think of super productive in the backfield making, you know, tackles for loss. And, you know, usually guys behind them are cleaning those things up, but Grover's doing that. Last thing I want to get to before we let you go, Steven, I think a big credit to Gus Bradley for what he did in the secondary on Sunday. You know, Nick Cross is a guy that they handed the starting strong safety job to, and I think they looked at it after a couple weeks and said, all right, with Kansas City, we can't have kind of a boomer bust guy playing safety for us. We need a little bit more of a reliable guy, maybe a little bit more of a veteran presence. Roddy McLeod inserted into the starting lineup. They trust Rodney Thomas, a rookie out of Yale. I mean, they made several secondary changes against Patrick Mahomes, and by all accounts, they all paid off.
Yeah, and I would add to that something that a couple guys talked about, including Stephon Gilmore, which is that they tightened up the coverage. And I think you saw the results of that. I mean, they made the windows tighter. They got hands on footballs the other day, and that's not something we've been seeing. So I think it's a great sign. One of the questions about Gus Bradley and his scheme just generally has been, has he kept up with the times? You know, this is not – he doesn't have the Legion of Boom, and we're not in 2013 anymore, right? The times have changed in the NFL. That's almost 10 years ago now, right? So he – the question was always, you know, would he be adaptable? And I think this is a great example of him doing just that. And it's great to see because – I always wondered, it's funny, with Nick Cross, as much as I understand the excitement, and I believe in his upside, I really do, I know what they see in him. I will say, I was a little surprised that from day one, they penciled him as a starter, and they were just ready to roll with that. And you just almost never see that with rookies, particularly not a third-round pick. Maybe a first-round pick, you do see that. But a third-rounder, I was always surprised that he was this unquestioned starter, not because of ability, but just because is he ready? And particularly, as you said, against a guy like Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid, who is just, you know, the master of disguise and fooling you. I think that was a great decision by the Colts to maybe ease up on that and maybe go another direction. You know, with the Rodney Thomas decision, you know, there, I just think that Nick Cross is a better fit at strong safety. And so they didn't want to, I think, shoehorn him in at free safety when that's not the position he's worked at either for the most part in practice. So it all makes sense in retrospect, and I respect their adaptability. Good stuff.
Steven, now that we've gotten everybody versed up on the D.B. Cooper documentaries, are you watching the Dahmer thing on Netflix?
You know, my wife started watching it and was trying to get me to watch it, and I don't know, I was on the fence, so I guess I got to do it on my own because she left me behind. So,
gosh, are you worried at all that she's the one that suggested that? Not to interfere with your relationship.
I had mixed feelings about it. I'm not going to lie. I was like, you know, I was like, you go to bed anytime soon or you going to watch this thing all night? You know, like, you're a little too into it. I was a little concerned, man. I don't know.
Steven's asleep with his eyes open tonight.
Eyes wide shut at the horror house.
You know?
It's pretty good, man. I will tell you this. It's pretty good, you know.
I'm going to have to cave and check it out because, yeah, she's invariably going to talk me to death about it, so I'm going to have to know what she's talking about, right?
Death being the key word there. We're only on episode 3, so if you want to come by and get caught up to speed, Steven, you're more than welcome. We'll make extra pork chops for you.
Okay, appreciate it.
All right. Steven Holder from ESPN.com. No, thanks, Steven.
Dahmer watch party tonight. Come on over. Jake and Shannon.
I don't know if you know this or not, Kevin, but
this one for Mr. Gilmore.
We need to divide up pork chops.
When I was in Milwaukee, I've been to a lot of the sites of the Jeffrey Dahmer, like his building. His building's no longer there. I've been to La Cage, which was the club where he met many of his acquaintances, that's actually portrayed in the show. Did you see the very beginning when it shows him going in the bar?
Yeah.
They did a good job of reenacting what La Cage looks like, I will say that. Pretty fascinating stuff. I've talked to his public defender before. Pretty fascinating stuff. The show so far, from what I've seen, is pretty on par with everything that I'd heard about it.
I honestly could see my wife wanting to watch that.
You know, the thing...
Now, again, it's not a documentary, right?
No, it is a reenactment or just a. I was in Milwaukee like two or three years ago. We go every year at Christmas time, Shannon and I do. And we were in Milwaukee and I went into a bar and they had a local beer that was named after Dahmer. And the bottle of the beer has like his mugshot on it. And I'm like, you know, I get it.
Except anything else on tap?
Yeah. Seriously. And in addition to that, I'm like, you know, listen, and I'm a weird fascination guy of weird fascinations, right? But I'm like, this was only 30 years ago. Like, his victims have family and friends that still live in the area. Like,
that's it's a bit not, much for me.
It's not like from 140 years ago, you know what I mean? So that seemed to me to be a little off.
Tony East going to chat Pacers with us here in about 5 minutes. Let's do a morning checkdown.
The Morning Checkdown.
Omaha! 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 Omaha!
Brought to you by Ball State Football. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com.
Omaha!
On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Okay, Jerry, we saw your tweet. The rest of you that are Cardinals fans, congratulations. St. Louis Cardinals are NL Central champions. They're in the postseason for the fourth straight year after yesterday defeating the Milwaukee Brewers in the 40-year anniversary of that 82 World Series between the Brew Crew and the Cardinals. Cardinals win 6-2 yesterday. Elsewhere in Major League Baseball, Pirates over the Reds 4-1. It was the Cubs doubling up Philly 2-1. Aaron Judge is still sitting on number 60 as he did not homer yesterday, but there were plenty of walks for him. Yankees over the Blue Jays nonetheless 5-2. Red Sox over Cute Fella 13-9. Indianapolis Indians 7-1 losers to Columbus.
Colts back to practice today outside of Shaquille Leonard. The Julian Blackman ankle watch would probably be the other injury to note. Certainly coming out of Sunday, and if you missed it, we had Jelani Woods on the show yesterday. That is up on our podcast. What Jelani Woods and Alec Pierce did late in that game, if you can build off that, that is massive for the Colts moving forward. Here was offense coordinator Marcus Brady on the two rookies yesterday.
So, I mean, part of it could be a defining moment for those guys. A lot of it building confidence is just having success. And so when they go out there and then have that success, then it just, you know, it bleeds confidence in themselves and it kind of springs them forward. So we're hoping we get that both out of our two young guys in Jelani and Alec, who, you know, made some big plays in the game. And, hopefully we get some more production out of that. And, we're looking forward to that. It'll definitely help our offense.
Jake, Frank Reich won the first three meetings against Mike Vrabel. Vrabel's won four of the last five. The Colts are 3.5-point favorites for Sunday. The game is on Fox. You don't typically see that. The CBS or two AFC teams on Fox.
Yeah, that's odd, right?
Adam Amin and Mark Schlereth will be on the call for that.
And your approval or disapproval of the broadcast team?
I don't know. I mean, I've certainly heard Schlereth and even Amin do games. Amin's a little bit on the younger broadcasting side. I don't have a strong opinion. And I know that might shock some people, but I don't have a Spiro-type opinion with this crew.
Who is... what?
I think people find Romo very polarizing.
I think Tony Romo in the beginning was... Tony Romo was like, not my father's root beer. You remember when Not My Father's Root Beer came out? And everyone and their brother's like, this stuff is unbelievable. I've never tasted anything like it. It's impossible to find. I've got to go on eBay and buy it. Did you hear? There's a grocery store in Saginaw, Michigan that has two extra cases. Let's drive up. And then after like 3 weeks of it, people were like, oh my gosh, it tastes like syrup. It's way too sweet. And that was the end of it. And Romo, the first game that he did, this guy's unbelievable. He's predicting plays before it even happens. He knows more than anybody's ever known about the football ever. And after 3 weeks, it was, oh my gosh, he won't shut up. Just let the play happen.
Jim! That's what he always says. He's always Jim. That's what I always hear him say.
Yeah, the emphasis that Jim Irsay has on Gilmore, he has that with Jim.
On Gilmore? No. What emphasis do we have? Does Jim Irsay have on Gilmore?
This one for Mr. Gilmore.
People keep asking me, by the way, hey, is there video that... Yes, that is off of Jim Irsay's Twitter account.
Didn't bug his house.
Yeah, there's gold on Jim Irsay's Twitter account. You just got to make sure you're following the big man. All right, speaking of big man, Myles Turner, the latest on him. Tony East is going to join us next. Pacers' first training camp practice yesterday. Sounds like the second unit had a pretty good day. We'll chat with Tony about that coming up here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
As a roofer, every second counts. Late deliveries and incomplete orders cost me time and money. That's why I partner with Beacon. Beacon's unique network of branches work together to get me what I need when I need it. Every branch working together. With Beacon, I know my supplies will be delivered on time and complete. Homeowners rely on me, so I rely on Beacon, because I never stop building, and neither do they. Go to BECN.com to get started building with Beacon. Beacon, always building.
A couple weeks back, I was in Kroger feeling a little parched, and I head to the drink section, and all of a sudden my eyes immediately drawn towards the awesome-looking can of Liquid Death. I don't know if you guys have seen this. But if you head to your local grocery, head to the beverage part of that grocery, and you look for the really cool, like, energy drink type looking can, it's Liquid Death, and that is Mountain Spring water that not only is going to quench your thirst, but also is helping out the future of our Earth. Outside of the cool looking tall boy can, Liquid Death, also 10% of all profits go to the killing of plastic pollution. As someone with a couple young kids, obviously that's top of mind for myself. So while you'll see Liquid Death at event venues around Indianapolis, you're also going to find them, again, at your local grocery, Kroger, Target, wherever. So head to the drink section. Find that cool-looking tall boy. They've got Mountain Spring water. I think there's a lime flavor as well. There's a black can, a green can, a white and gold can. You can quit your thirst with that ice-cold water while also doing some great things for the future of our world.
JMV here for the absolute best in water. That's Connecticut water. And my friends Joe and John will set you up with a Premier Series water softener. And here's a game changer for you in your home. The K5 in-home drinking water station. We're told all the time to hydrate, drink lots of water. This is the way to do it with my friends at Connecticut. Two locations, northeast side, Castleton, south side, US 31 and Southport Road. The Connecticut water app, download that to your smartphone or device today. Or ConnecticutIndy.com.
Don't you love fall in Indy, but you hate the paint? Well, do what your neighbor Mark did. He called Rhino Shield.
It's a two-story home built in 1992. Around 2001, looking at needing the paint, I heard a radio ad, with Rhino Shield, you won't have to paint again for another 25 years.
That's because Rhino Shield's not paint. It's better.
They're very professional. We had everything done. Everything that would typically be painted on a house was done, and it was very fast.
All right, Indy, get the 25-year guaranteed protection of Rhino Shield right now for 15% off the regular price.
It was done in 2001 and still going strong. From what I've seen on our home, they can easily offer a 25-year guarantee and not worry about it.
Here's owner Shane Smith.
This offer is limited, so call me at 888-RHINO-41. That's 888-RHINO-41.
Don't paint.
Don't vinyl.
Go Rhino.
Don't vinyl, go Rhino Shield. Never paint your house again. Rhino Shield.
Decades of tradition.
And this is a moment that's memories of
tailgating.
in any kind of weather.
The snow coming down nearly in chunks now.
Face painting and school colors. All the ingredients for the American Standard College Football Saturday. It's a Big Ten battle starting at noon as Michigan travels to Iowa City to take on the Hawkeyes. Then stay tuned as second-ranked Alabama takes on Arkansas in an SEC showdown. American Standard College Football Saturday on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
It is 26 minutes before the hour of 9 o'clock. This is Kevin and Query on 93.5, 107.5 The Fan. Day two of the Pacers season, somewhat speaking, from a practice standpoint. Yesterday was practice number one. Somewhat of an abbreviated practice. I think some of the roster was surprised by the quick nature of practice yesterday, although I'm sure they weren't complaining about it. Joining us now on the Payless Liquors guest line to talk about the Pacers and more is Tony East, who joins us periodically to talk about the blow in gold. Tony, how are you?
Doing well. It was interesting that it was shorter, that they, you know, moved out to do film after their practice, but such is life of a new era of Pacers basketball.
Tony, I wanted to start with a comment Rick Carlisle made on Media Day, and part of me is like, oh, that's coach speak. But then I thought to, like, writing out playing time and lineups and bench unit and all of it, I'm like, you know what? He might be onto something here. Carlisle used the phrase 10-man rotation at a minimum. Do you believe that?
I do, mostly because of what you said. When you write down all the guys that they almost have to play for some reason or another, whether it's a young player they're trying to develop or someone that they've promised a starting spot at a certain position or someone new they got, they need to explore their talents. They almost have to play at least 10. And even 10 leaves out someone like Terry Taylor or O'Shea Brissett, depending on who they decide to play or something like that. So that's why 10 at a minimum is actually true in the case of this younger team that will be experimenting a lot this year with various lineups, something Rick Carlisle likes to do in general. They'll be trying to figure out who fits with who. They'll be trying to maximize Benedict Mathurin and Tyrese Haliburton and a bunch of other guys in the mix. So I totally believe that, given the priorities they're going to have with this new team, they will try to play 10 guys every game, which sometimes might, even he even said this, which surprised me, sometimes that might even keep Tyrese Haliburton's minutes down a little lower than you'd expect. But if that is what it takes to get the guys out there that they want every game, they're going to do it.
And obviously you're going to have injuries, but just to kind of play this out here, Carlisle mentioned yesterday the second unit was dominant, and that was T.J. McConnell, Benedict Mathurin, Aaron Nesmith, Terry Taylor, and Isaiah Jackson. Their starters, Myles Turner, Jalen Smith, Chris Duarte, Buddy Hield, Tyrese Haliburton. Tony, with those 10 names, we haven't mentioned Andrew Nembhard, Daniel Tice, Goga Batadze, and O'Shea Brissett.
Yeah, the third unit they even had running was impressive. Like, James Johnson was running with that crew yesterday, too. Like, he was in the rotation for a team that made the playoffs last year, and, you know, he shouldn't play for the Pacers, given that they're leaning in on youth and a long-term project. But just the nature of their team and the guys they have, like, someone decent to, or at least young and interesting, is probably not going to play in some games. And I think it might depend game by game. You know, last year, if you'll remember, O'Shea Brissett didn't start in the rotation either. They went with Torrey Craig and Justin Holiday, and it took a few games to really switch that around and have O'Shea become an everyday player. So I think there could be some tweaking and variation with those groups in the rotation as the season goes on, as their record progresses, as maybe trades or injuries pop up, because kind of how Carlisle rolls and sort of what's going to be necessary for a team with so many guys kind of worthy of sort of exploring their potential and playing.
Tony, really dumb question here. I was at the tail end of practice yesterday during the media availability. I did not see Daniel Tice. Is he here yet, do you know? I thought maybe he was participating in something else that delayed him getting here by a bit. Am I off?
He got here recently. He was doing his medical testing, and he's sick. So it's not COVID. They confirmed he had to get more negative tests before he could return to practice. So he might start on Wednesday if that testing was negative yesterday and this morning. And if not, then maybe we'll see him in a future day. But he is in Indy. He's just not practicing yet.
Gotcha. And Nembhard is a guy, from what I can tell, Tony.
And the rookie from Gonzaga, for those that don't
correct,
know.
Who was the second-round draft pick and starts out as the number three point guard. But, boy, I'll tell you what, I mean, very early, but it seems as though the Pacers brass are really excited about the possibility of kind of getting a steal there and a guy that they think might get minutes in some rotation spots this year. Do you get that same impression?
Yeah, they were talking about, you know, that's a tough one. The first pick of the second round, you got to wait out a lot of picks to get the guy. And if you want someone like Andrew Nembhard, they had to wait it out. And he is an interesting fit on this team. He fits kind of the MO that it looks like Carlisle is chasing with their point guards, which is guys who are good passers and good at moving the ball to someone else in the right way in traffic. He showed that in summer league, which it's summer league, but showing off of a skill that people think you're going to be good at is still important. And it'll be fascinating to see if they can get him minutes this year, because it's an interesting kind of gap in perception. He was the first pick of the second round, so you call him the second round pick. But if you get picked one pick earlier, right, one slot earlier, you're a first round pick. And on a developing team, you always talk about, oh, you got to get your first round picks minutes, right? So the perception of one pick kind of changes how much people feel like he should and needs to play. But yeah, being the 31st pick is still just right outside that first round range, and they clearly like the way he can pass and run the second unit. I'll be interested to see if they can get him on the floor this year, because the other part of media day that was interesting is, and Kevin Pritchard talked about this in his press conference last week, TJ McConnell fits the way they're trying to play pretty well, and he's kind of an important vet to this team as sort of taking on a leadership role. You know, he'll presumably play every game, so it's going to be hard to find Andrew Nembhard minutes at point guard where he can really have the ball and push the pace. But it seems like, you know, that they like him and would like to get him out there somehow. So they'll have to get creative in that way too. They have a lot of rotation decisions that will be tough this year.
Tony, we talked a lot about Myles Turner and his future here earlier in the show. I know that's a subject we've probably talked annually about, so let's not focus on it here. Let's concentrate more on his fit with Tyrese Haliburton. We didn't see them on the floor last year. We didn't see Turner on the floor with, you know, Buddy Hield either. Now is a solo big, now playing with a pass-first point guard. What do you think can be tapped into with a healthy Turner?
Yeah, I think that the pass-first part is key there, because it's weird to go back so far for this, but two of Turner's better seasons statistically and shooting the ball were the first two seasons of the Victor Oladipo era, 2017-18 and 18-19. And Darren Collison was the point guard then. I don't think Darren Collison was a brilliant setup passer or anything like that, but he was, in Turner's time with the Pacers, the best point guard the Pacers have had at getting him the ball in the pick and pop. And that gave him, you know, the best chances to shoot from deep and to get shots from the spots that he likes. And so I think that is where Tyrese Haliburton's abilities as a passer and a setup man and his really good skill reading the game will really shine. If he can get Turner the ball, similar to how Darren Collison did, just dumping it backwards on pick and pops and using him well in the pick and roll, it seems like you're going to have Turner set some more screens this year. You know, Carlisle last year even was talking about using Turner as a lob threat, which never materialized. But, you know, I think that they should, in theory, fit pretty well together in that way, just as a guy who can either roll or pop, and Tyrese is very good at reading the game depending on which one he does. So it seems like Turner should get the ball in his spot at the right time with a good pass, but you know, they'll have to explore what that fit actually looks like. You know, Turner definitely better at popping than rolling, but you can't do the same thing over and over again and expect success. So I think they on paper fit well together. Floor spacers are always valuable. It seems like Turner will be a little more involved this year, especially after his comments last December. But the question is, you know, he's playing with three starters who he's never played with before. How can he find his spots, and can those guys set him up for success?
Tony East is our guest on the Palos Sugars guest line. You can read his work about the Pacers at Forbes and then Locked On Sports. Tony, not named Tyrese Haliburton, I want you to tell me the player on this Pacers roster that would have the most market value universally across the board in the rest of the NBA.
It's got to be Benedict Mathurin, right? Just because he was just...
Well, yeah, I guess...
How dare you forget about him, Jake?
That's right. Well, okay, let's say of players that have played games for the Pacers before. I probably should have prefaced that.
Sure. I think Chris Duarte would have some value around the league as an all-rookie guy last year, and he's tricky to kind of pin down from a value perspective because he was good last year, obviously. He projects to be a guy who can really shoot it with his skill set. Is still adding to his game, but he's already 25, right? So how do teams marry that up in their head? How do they kind of decide what's more important, the amount of time he's been in the NBA or his skill set? Will be interesting going forward. But he's a good fit with Haliburton as a shooter and a guy who can make a shot off of a few dribble moves. That seems like the perfect kind of secondary creator type that you would want. And it sounds like, you know, based off what we heard in the lineups in yesterday's practice, he was in the starting group in day one. We'll see how fluid those lineups are, as Carlisle does like to tinker a little bit. But yeah, you know, it seems like he would be the most valuable guy given his age and expertise and what he's good at. But there's a, you know, Buddy Hield obviously has been in trade chatter all summer. If he can be the guy he was for the Pacers last year, more so than the guy he was for the Kings, it seems like that value will continue to go up if he can actually pass and rebound in a way that nobody really thought he could. So it seems like those two guys will lead the pack. Isaiah Jackson, obviously very interesting, but at this stage, you know, a guy who just made All-Rookie last year and a veteran who can really shoot it would be the leaders in the clubhouse.
You know, I get the feeling, Tony, Duarte to me is interesting because I look at Chris Duarte and I think to myself, he's a Doug Christie type player. He's a, you know, one of those like kind of versatile sixth men type guys. If Chris Duarte is your fifth or sixth guy, you're a really good mid-50s win team. If Chris Duarte is one of your is your second or third option, you're 25-57. You agree with that?
That makes some sense to me. And I think the thing about Duarte that's interesting as I've kind of watched him through the years is he projects more to be an elite shooter and not as good off the dribble guy to me than the other way around, which sort of breaks, you know, Doug Christie was still a good shooter, but sort of breaks the Christie mold to an extent to me. But I still think even that kind of player is valuable as a sixth man to come in and sort of change the way a defense has to guard a team. So, yeah, I agree with you on that to an extent. I think that if he can become a really good defender, that would sort of change his perspectives and outlook. That would make him a guy that you could use in your starting box to shut down other wings. But in general, you know, if he adds to his game in a way where he can beat someone off the dribble and get to the rim or something like that, it would make a lot of sense that he would be that six-man type that really ignites the second unit more so than, you know, a guy who's trying to break defenses with the starters.
I need to YouTube that Doug Christie, Kobe Bryant fight. That was pretty entertaining, if I remember correctly. Tony, last one from me. The Pacers are done with Myles Turner and Domantas Sabonis as a pairing. Jalen Smith is a guy that I think there are some questions on. Can he be like a true four in the modern NBA? I know talking to Chad Buchanan last week, the Pacers love what Jalen Smith has done this offseason. How do you kind of compare and contrast Turner and Sabonis on the floor together to now Turner and Jalen Smith?
Yeah, everybody was using Turbonus last year. We'll have to come up with new phrasing for Turner and Smith, but it's not as easy to merge those names together. You know, the offensive fit is fascinating because, you know, I think that they can both shoot it a little bit better than Sabonis could, at least if Smith can keep up the numbers he had from deep last year with the Pacers, and it sounds like they're high on the growth he's made this summer. And he's a little more mobile than Sabonis, not that Sabonis didn't work on that during his time with the Pacers, but in general, I think that they can do a little more in terms of being on the perimeter and moving around more than they could, you know, where Sabonis would, you know, always start on the right side and try to do his handoffs and his sets from that direction. And I think they can be a little more versatile and mobile with their current group, but obviously neither of them have the post skills Sabonis had, so it'll be harder to play inside out. And on defense, we're already back to hearing what we heard before, where the question for Jalen Smith will be, can he be more mobile and defend out on the perimeter? He was talking about that at Media Day. Rick Carlisle mentioned it on Media Day. And if he can, it's going to be a clunky fit at times, right? Fours are just going to feast on this Pacers team. They can't put Turner on them because then he's not around the basket. So I think they can fit well because they're both mobile-ish big men. But the defensive fit, like it was with the old two-center pairing, might be awkward at times. And that's sort of the pitfalls of a younger team that you have guys who you need to playing a little out of position.
At T East NBA on Twitter, and Tony, with the preseason opening up next Wednesday and the regular season opening up two more Wednesdays from that, I want to give an opportunity for you to plug kind of where your content is at. I think it's outstanding content. I always enjoy our conversations, but for fans that maybe have not come across your content, where can we find a little bit of everything?
All over the place. Yeah, for Pacers content, daily podcast called Locked On Pacers, broken down the first practice for today, stuff from Media Day around the league, like Malcolm Brogdon saying the Pacers let him choose his destination in a trade, which is fascinating. Writing for Forbes and the West Side Community News and for the Fever Front at the Next Hoop. So lots of ways to dive in and learn more about pro basketball here in Indiana.
Tony, always love our conversations. Looking forward to more of them coming up here in the fall and winter.
Wonderful. Thanks for having me, guys.
That is Tony East right there on the Payless Liquors hotline.
I'm telling you, man, I've got a level of like intrigue is a better word than excitement about this Pacers team, but I think it's going to be intrigue. I mean,
I'm legitimately very excited to watch the Pacers.
Are you going to come to a game?
Yeah. Do you think they'll invite us back for human bowling and the knockout. Hey, I was better at the human bowling than I was the knockout.
You got a strike on the human bowling, and that was like right when we started, right? I mean, I think we'd been doing the show for like a week at that point, right?
That's why Kevin got QC Kinetics, because he's like, my shoulder.
Yeah, well, it was the neck, really. But sometimes you got to sacrifice.
Now, was it Pacers or Colts where you guys did the St. Elmo deal?
The Colts.
That was Colts.
That was Colts.
Raiders game.
Boy, you know, now looking back on it, Mark, did we start the downfall?
No. We couldn't be blamed for that. Could we?
That was when Jake faked COVID.
Yeah.
No, it was not fake, man. I'm telling you.
3 weeks in of pairing with you, I'm out. See you later. I'm saw out. You guys.
Allergies.
I'm like, man.
Acting up.
Man, the old veteran card.
That was
right
crazy.
Do the St. Elmo shrimp eating contest. We noted it earlier, that second unit yesterday, TJ McConnell, Benedict Mather, and Terry Taylor. In Rick Carlisle's words, they dominated the starters. Jake, this season, you know, you think about playing style and how those guys are wired. McConnell, Taylor, Matherin, those are probably guys that would fall in the, you want them on your team and they're going to be a bit pesky on the other side of it.
It's interesting when you mentioned the second unit dominating, and I thought, you know what? What did they tell us about Matherin? That this is a guy that
wound tight. Wasn't that what Chad Buchanan said?
Yeah, and he said, like, you know, he'll follow you in the hallway after you guys, if you get done playing, right? So, I don't know. It'd be fun to watch. A lot of young guys.
On the road to start the preseason, that is next Wednesday, and then the preseason opener, two Wednesdays over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. We'll talk a little IU football at the top of there. Maybe sneak in a basketball question with Dustin Dupirak at Nebraska. An important one for bowl eligibility for the Hoosiers coming up on Saturday night. We'll get back in the Colts conversation next year. Maybe hand out, should we hand out like a rookie of the week award maybe?
Sounds good.
You want to do that next?
Yeah, we'll do that.
We'll do that here. 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Exmark makes the mowers that care for the lawns, that set the stage for the backyard life. As the commercial mowers more landscape pros trust, Exmark mowers get you on and off the lawn without compromising cut quality, comfort, or reliability. Exmark, official mowers of the backyard life. Check out end-of-season pricing on Exmark mowers and stand-on aerator rentals right now at Midstate Truck Equipment on Allisonville Road in Fishers. Midstate Truck Equipment, 800-540-4479.
Yeah, as Mark was saying, as I'm kind of stretching out the back, the neck area right now, maybe it's flaring up again. If you have joint pain like I do, you need to dial up QC Kinetics. We're talking any joint pain, knees, hips, back, shoulder. You give QC Kinetics a call, and they'll get you a free consultation. The beauty about QC Kinetics is modern advances in regenerative medicine that allow the medical professionals to take the remarkable healing properties from your own body, concentrate them for maximum power, and then put them directly into your aching joints so your damaged tissue can be repaired and restored naturally. We're talking no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. So you give QC Kinetics a call, 463-235-7160. They've got locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. A free consultation awaits you. So again, QC Kinetics, 463-235-7160.
BetMGM, the king of sportsbooks, unleashes the spirit of Las Vegas with BetMGM Rewards. Every time you make a wager at BetMGM, you can earn BetMGM Rewards points that you can then redeem for online bonus credits like free bets. It's never been easier to join the action on the new BetMGM app, featuring a fresh redesign with improved features and quicker navigation. Planning a trip to Vegas? You can also convert your BetMGM points into MGM Rewards points that you can use towards dining, shows, and hotel rooms at over 20 MGM properties located on the Las Vegas Strip and nationwide. BetMGM Rewards is sports betting's premier loyalty program, including exclusive offers, incredible experiences, and valuable perks when you wager with BetMGM. Sign up with BetMGM or log in today to take advantage of BetMGM Rewards. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. Must be 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. If you or somebody you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Verizon Connect has a new AI dash cam with dual cameras. It's sleek, simple, and easy to install. Oh, and did I mention, it's AI smart. It'll give your team real-time alerts.
Tailgating.
And each video is automatically classified and sent to your team, giving you context to help coach your drivers. Best yet, it seamlessly works in one platform that tracks your vehicles, dispatches jobs, and much more. See how Verizon Connect can help manage your fleet at verizonconnect.com/radio.
O'Reilly Auto Parts specializes in keeping your car on the road. Not sure how much life is left in your battery? Our professional parts people will test it for free. If it does need to be replaced, we'll help you find just the right one to fit your car. Our Superstar batteries are built to handle even the toughest conditions. Visit O'Reilly Auto Parts today.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Start a new career with a job that keeps your community safe. The Marion County Sheriff, Carrie Forrestal, is hiring detention deputies to work in the brand new Community Justice Center. You'll supervise and guard offenders, making Marion County a better place to live. Starting pay begins at around $40,000 a year with a $5,000 signing bonus. Enjoy great benefits like complete health coverage and pension plan. Start your career as a detention deputy and earn the respect of your community. Apply today at joinmcso.indy.gov.
Mets, Braves, Sunday Night Baseball. The action begins at 7 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
So, see, I see what Mark is doing here. We're talking about rookies, so he's playing New Kids on the Block. Is that right?
Man,
look at that.
Out.
Look at that chemistry right
hanging
there.
Hanging tough.
This is the soon-to-be wildly popular and surprisingly unsponsored Rookies of the Week segment that we're going to do, right?
Correct.
For the Colts. Now, we only have a handful of rookies from which to pick.
You could go rookie or newcomer, but let's focus on rookies
okay.
here.
Okay.
And your winner, Jake, for last weekend for the Colts?
The obvious answer here would be Jelani Woods, who caught two touchdown passes on his first two receptions as a pro player. We had him on the program yesterday.
Maybe that was his award.
That's right. He gets two game balls, right?
Got an up close and personal view of Kevin's obsession with Tiger Woods. It was his reward.
Yeah. Fandom.
Mark, you seem hostile about the Tiger Woods thing.
No, I like putting that rejoiner together. That was fun for me.
I thought for a guy that plays a position where people expect immediate results and where probably some patience is required to wait for those results. A guy that made a couple of nice plays for them and showed that, yes, in fact, do not write him off. He is here possibly for the long haul and showed the promise in terms of his flexibility that we anticipated. I will go with Alec Pierce.
I like that. Bouncing back from the drop in week one, Jake, I think the go ball you saw to him on that Kansas City sideline, there needs to be one or two of those every week because Pierce just has that ability. I'm going to go Rodney Thomas II at safety. First NFL action on defense. He does it in the middle of the game when Julian Blackman leaves. He does it against Patrick Mahomes. And think about that. If he makes one mistake, 60,000 people know it, notice it. You know, there's no covering up anything when you're that deep safety. And against that quarterback, to handle that, I thought he seeked out some plays. He looked like he belonged. And again, it's not like he prepared all week necessarily for it with practice reps and everything. Blackman gets hurt. Nick Cross, the Colts don't feel totally comfortable, I think, in that free safety role. Rodney Thomas was that. Kudos to the Yale product for delivering on that front. We'll see if Indiana can deliver in Lincoln on Saturday night. Dustin Napierak from the Bulletin Herald Times joins us next.
School is in session.
Today, we celebrate Chris Jones. God, am I glad you got a big mouth at least late. And I don't know what you said. And in my world, you could say anything at that time, and I am not throwing a flag. But I am not the referee. I am a man that jumped out of my seat when I saw they had called the penalty. Thank you, Chris Jones!
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
If you have questions about buying a home or if you're ready to get pre-approved, everything starts today at thehomeloanexpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
Ball State football is back in Muncie this Saturday as the Cards take on Northern Illinois at 2 p.m. Secure tickets at ballstatesports.com or charge by phone 888-PSU-TICKET. Chirp, chirp.
Those who've built their own financial success know that moving forward requires not just the right tools, but an in-depth knowledge of how to use them. That's why Edelman Financial Engines gives you a dedicated wealth planner supported by a team of experts. We know a modern wealth planning relationship demands human insight powered by advanced technology. Our advice is tailor-made for your personal goals, and our investment management approach is based on Nobel Prize-winning research. We model more than 38,000 securities so we can better stress test your portfolio through thousands of scenarios. See what we can build for you. Call 888-899-4450. That's 888-899-4450. Or visit EFEWealthPlanners.com to get your complimentary financial plan. Edelman Financial Engines. Built for those who built themselves.
It's the BullseyeEventGroup.com Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. All you can eat, all you can drink, 3 hours before kickoff inside the Bullseye Event Center right across the street from Lucas Oil Stadium. Get your passes today. BullseyeEventGroup.com for the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. All you can eat and the food presented by Food Network Chef Aaron May. Bullseye Event Group offers indoor and outdoor climate control lounge seating for a VIP tailgate experience. All ages welcome. Go to BullseyeEventGroup.com and get your tickets now.
Hey, it's Big Joe for your trusted local independent America Standard heating and air conditioning dealer, Reinhart Heating and Cooling. Owner Danny Reinhart says putting his kids in charge of more of the day-to-day operations of the business was the plan all along.
It makes me really proud that I know that I can turn it over to my family and they can take care of things, and I've got all the confidence in the world in them. And that's the legacy I'm proud to leave.
A great family-owned business, Reinhart Heating and Cooling. 317-745-4526. Reinhart's your trusted local independent America Standard dealer.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The Colts host the division rival Tennessee Titans. Coverage Sunday morning at 10. On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's Kevin and Querry.
What the hell are you doing, John?
Come back and get it. Charlie, come back toward the ball.
If he's coming, I'm going to engage him, and then I'm going to slip out into the screen.
Concentrate. Get better. Say to yourself, I got to get better.
On 93.5.
Boom, baby.
And 107.5, The Fan.
Honestly, it's probably never a good thing when you're facing an team that's led by an interim head coach and you're a 5.5-point underdog, but I guess that's reality for Indiana this Saturday night at Nebraska. That is a night game from Lincoln. I believe I saw sold out, which pretty impressive for the Cornhusker fan base. Dustin DePierak covers IU Athletics for the Bloomington Herald Times. He joins us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Dustin, Jake and I were talking earlier. I feel like this is the game at 3-1, and as you map out the rest of the Big Ten slate, this kind of falls in the really need to have it for the bowl game scenario. Like a loss on Saturday and all of a sudden the margin for error is you got to get Maryland, you got to get Rutgers, and then you got to get Purdue or Michigan State.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think 100%. They're in a big hole if they don't get this one. This is one of the most winnable games left on the board. They're obviously 1-3 so far with their only win coming against North Dakota. This is a team that you absolutely have to beat. And it's weird to say that because you are talking about going to Lincoln and beating somebody and that being a must-win for Indiana, and that certainly was not supposed to be the case when Nebraska joined the Big Ten. That was, Indiana should never be in the game. But obviously that's sort of what happened in Nebraska. But yeah, no, that's where they are. I mean, there's not a whole lot of very winnable games left on the board. I mean, I think there are a couple more that are more winnable. Michigan State certainly is more, I think, vulnerable than I think we expected. You know, Purdue is maybe worse than I thought they were week one. But I think if you're Indiana, you don't want to go into November needing to win at all to get a bowl game. So I think, yeah, Nebraska is an absolute must-have.
Bigger dog, Indiana against Nebraska or the one in the background?
She barks much, much bigger than she actually is. She's a tiny little beagle, and she just thinks she's
Beagles are the best, man. Beagles are the best.
I was at a Cleveland Browns game, and all of a sudden the dog pound is...
There's a squirrel somewhere in Johnson County, and the dog's going bonkers.
Yeah, she totally knows where it is, and she has thoughts about it.
Of course.
There's probably a cat across the street. That's really what's happening. She's not okay with what the neighbor's cats do at all, because they run around free, and she's not cool with that one bit.
Hey, Dustin... I was talking to somebody yesterday, and I want you to jump in on this because this is probably way off base. But I was talking to somebody yesterday that's pretty dialed in with Indiana Athletics, And I made the reference to Tom Allen, who I know everybody likes. I mean, he's a great guy, and I think everybody wants to see him do well. Mm-hmm. And this person said to me, you know, his leash may be shorter than people realize right now. You believe that?
I could buy it. I mean, you know, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I guess that's the question of what do people realize it is. I can't see the trigger being pulled after this year, just because I think it's if I'm doing the math right, it's a $25 million buyout.
$25 million.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's because it was a 7-year extension. I mean, I'd have to Google this, but I have looked it up at some point this year, so I got to make sure I'm Googling this right. Remember, he's even with the pay cut, because remember he took a $200,000 a year pay cut to basically for Nick Sheridan's buyout. As far as I understand it, but basically once he announced that he was getting rid of Nick Sheridan, he took a $200,000 buyout or took a $2,000 pay cut, but he's still at $4.7 million a year. And I think it was like a 7-year extension. So, you know, like you're talking, you know, obviously they would have gone through 2 years of that at this point. But so you're still talking about like 25.3 left on it. And I think it's 100% until maybe the last 2 years that they would have to pay him. So, you know, I mean, I suppose there are obviously rich Indiana alums out there, and they managed to find somebody to give $10 million for Archie's. But 2.5 times that. For football, that is a lot. And I'm sure they're in better shape, you know, financially. You can certainly look down the road, certainly with the Big Ten media deal and everything that's coming, and say, okay, well, there's going to be more money for stuff like that, and you can't be in a position for football to be a train wreck that whole time. But man, I mean, I would really, you know, I guess that just sort of thinks, okay, where is the leash now? Do I think you can't keep, you know, losing, you can't keep stacking 2 and 10 seasons to get the whole of your 7-year deal. That's certainly not possible. So, you know, I mean, I don't think they're going to, you know, be willing to stack 5 bad years or somewhere on that range. But, you know, I mean, I would have to think he gets at least another one, probably 2. Just because the size of that, I mean, they trust him, they like him, and you know, they might sort of demand, hey, you know, there are maybe in particular one assistant that we think you really, really got to get rid of if you want to keep your job. But I can't see throwing that much money at an Indiana football coach not to coach. I just can't see it happening. Especially if they go 4-8, 5-7 somewhere on that range where it's not atrocious by Indiana standards, where it's basically what the Indiana standard is over the course of its history. So yeah, I mean, there are certainly fans that are more angry. You can definitely, you know, sort of sense that. And I think Scott Dolson just in general is going to have a quicker trigger, I think, than Fred Glass would have. You know, I think Fred really labored over, like, you know, getting rid of Bill Lynch. Like, that was hard for him to do. Scott, I think, and Fred has even said, you know, basically, like, there were times when I wanted this cup to pass over me, and Scott was like, nah, I think you got to make this move, man. So I think Scott is going to be more willing to step back and say, all right, does it have to be done? Then it has to be done. Certainly that's what he did with Archie Miller. So I don't think he'd be totally opposed to it with Tom at some point. But I'd just be surprised if they throw that kind of money at somebody to go away, because then you have to pay the next guy more. So you're probably talking about $10 million just in head football coaches per year while you're paying off that buyout. So, you know, that certainly is going to be a financial piece that they're going to have to, you know, be aware of.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, the $25 million number, and then, you know, if IU wins one or two more games, they've hit their over on the expectation.
Yeah, exactly.
Coming into this season. Dustin DePerrick from the Bloomington Herald Times is with us. I think you hinted at it in your answer right there and pointing to an assistant coach. I assume you're referencing the offensive line. Now that the non-conference slate is complete, Dustin, where would you maybe point to for the biggest positive exiting that and the biggest negative exiting the non-conference?
Well, I think the biggest, you know, the one thing they really do well is, oh my God, sorry, Maxine, I'm going to go outside here. I would say the one thing that they've really done well, at least, is, you know, convert passing plays on third down. And what I think that stands out to is that, I mean, Basil, I can at least fling it around a little bit. He certainly hasn't been perfect. I think he's only completing about 53% of his passes. So he certainly had some misfires. But you're seeing that connection between him and Cam Camper. And I think the fact that they've established kind of a go-to guy that they can rely on when all else is going wrong, I think is pretty important. And that stands out. Certainly he was a, you know, junior college kid that, you know, nobody had heard of a couple years ago, basically was barely recruited out of high school, tried to walk on at Sam Houston State, and didn't even get an opportunity there, went to junior college, grew like 5 inches or something like that, and, you know, now he's a go-to wide receiver in the Big Ten. And so there's that is probably the best part of the passing game, and that's probably the best piece that they've got going. And I think the linebackers are playing really well. Cam Jones and Aaron Casey have been terrific, but really both sides of the ball have issues. Obviously, I think the offensive line is quite shaky. They're going to have to ask themselves some questions this week, and I wouldn't be surprised if you see some people that you have not seen starting in there next week. And in particular, I would say Josh Sales and Khalil Benson will be the guys who have the best bet to be maybe new additions to the lineup after Parker Hannah had some issues. And I think it's been kind of a flip back and forth at right guard between Weaver and Benson, and I think Benson's been better. I mean, I don't know everything about O-line play, and I haven't watched every play, but he seems to move the pile a lot more than Weaver does. Certainly the running game has struggled because the O-line hasn't been great. You know, Bazelak has faced not an overwhelming amount of pressure, but plenty. So that's been an issue. I think just in terms of surprising negatives, the secondary has not been great. I think they obviously were put on some islands against Cincinnati because Indiana was just really going to try to stop the run. And, you know, put a lot of guys in one-on-one coverage, you know, without safety help. And that really did not, you know, go well in the Cincinnati game. And they really changed the game plan in the second half to make sure that there was more safety help back there. And considering you're looking at a secondary that's got three all Big Ten guys from 2020, you would have thought that would have been more of a strength. So I think that's the biggest concern that you have. Obviously, again, everybody had a sense that the line wasn't going to be drastically better because they didn't really add much to it. But the secondary should be a thing that should be probably the best part of this roster. And it hasn't necessarily been so far.
When you look at Dustin, you know, Indiana having obviously the great year, going to the bowl game against Ole Miss, finishing ranked in the top 10 or 15, and, you know, it was a COVID year. I realize it was kind of an odd year, but from a recruiting standpoint, you only get so long a window to kind of cash in on when you're cachet. Did Indiana do that properly?
I mean, to cash in, yes, but the problem, let me answer it this way. You should have been able to extend that window. I think that's the major issue, is that basically when you have a year like that for Indiana, you shouldn't just get, you should be able to parlay that into another good season, so that you have, you know, sort of continued momentum. I think they did a pretty good job of putting together the 2022 class. I mean, they certainly maximized they got a lot of players last summer. And I think that was certainly really important. And they really carried that momentum. They were really putting themselves out there, you know, just not being shy at all about the fact they were going to be top 25 and the whole bit. And they got a lot of players to, you know, to commit. And they managed to keep most of those guys in the 2022 class. I mean, that's why that class is rated really high. I've said this before elsewhere, but like, Tom Allen is a very hard guy to break a promise to, but it's a lot easier to just never make a promise to Tom Allen. You know, basically, like if you commit something to Tom Allen, like it rips your soul out to have to say, no, I'm not going to do that. Because those guys, you know, and so you saw that class hung together even after they went 2-10. A lot of those guys stayed. They lost the quarterback from Texas, Josh Hoover, which is, I think, a pretty big loss. And there were a couple other pieces that they lost towards the, you know, basically towards signing day. But I mean, they still get guys like Amari Cooper, and they picked up Jalen Lucas late, you know, Travell Mullen, you know, James Mullen. They got a lot of highly recruited guys. Deshaun McCullough stuck around even though his dad left. So they maximized on that offseason, basically, that in between 2020 and 21. They got probably as much as they could out of that. But it's like, you know, then I think, and they did okay, I think, even after the season, just sort of putting the last pieces of that class together. It's pretty talented 2022, but you're seeing 2023 is harder. And, you know, basically when you carry that 2-10 record all off season, how hard is to get in people's, you know, basically get people to commit to you when they have other options. And so, I mean, I think they only got maybe, what, seven guys or something like that recruited. Now, they were never going to have a big class just because, you know, of they're just not losing that much. And there's only so many, you know, and they're going to keep some scholarships open for transfers and that kind of deal. But, you know, nobody's really, basically nobody in this recruiting class in the 2023 class really, you know, makes headlines. I mean, we haven't written about many of them because we kind of set a high bar for that. And I think they've only got seven guys. They don't have any four stars yet. So you can see the difference being made there. I mean, you know, if you're Indiana, you need to stack classes. You need to get, you know, a bunch in a row that are really good. And even if you're going to get a small one, it's got to pack a punch to it. And so I think you're going to see that if, you know, if they go 4-8, 5-7 this year, then 2024 is a harder class to recruit for. And then you're going to have a real hard time getting four-star guys. You know, it's not that you need a ton of them if you're Indiana, but just need one or two in a class and have those three stars be kind of on the higher end to start moving the needle for you. But you could easily find yourself back in the position where the only teams you're beating are MAC schools. And that's really where they don't want to be, because that's what's really put them in, really buried them in years past.
Last one for me, and Dustin Dupirak from the Bloomington Herald Times is with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Dustin, kind of, I guess, switching over to basketball. I think Midnight Madness or whatever they call it now is coming up at some point here. And the next,
who's your hysteria, Kevin? Come on, man. Hoosier, you weren't at that school. What are you talking about?
I know. You can see how out of touch I am. And the first game, I think, whatever, early November, it would be my guess on that front. You've been all over the, I guess, spring story of Xavier Johnson and his arrest. Is the latest and maybe the final update on that, no suspension, status quo?
Yep. He had to give up his car, though.
I did see that.
I asked Mike about that. He said, you know, we're kind of past that. And that's one of those deals, basically, where the best time to get in trouble is right after your season ends, because then you've got all off season to get yourself in good graces. And that obviously seems to be what he did, because, you know, Woodson basically raved about how good Johnson's been this off season and said he's been really taking care of stuff on and off the field. And it wasn't a joke. I mean, like he kind of like laughed about it at the time, but apparently he approached, Xavier's parents and said, he's not going to have a car here this season. And so just to sort of take that piece out of it. That's it. I think that you could say without much of a question that if he would have done the same thing in February, it's a couple game suspension. But when you do it in April and you have between April and November to not play any basketball games, they're not, you know, coaches are a lot less likely to hold it against you if you spend all that off season, you know, just doing things right. And obviously it certainly helped that he was able to get the felony charge dismissed. And ends up with just a reckless driving, and it's a Class C misdemeanor, and, you know, like a lot of people would just say, well, it's a glorified speeding ticket. That doesn't necessarily carry for the whole course of the offseason to the point you still want to suspend him. But I think the car matters, you know. I mean, I think that's something to say, all right, you know, like you're going to spend this entire season walking around and taking the bus. That's your punishment for doing this. It was dumb, you know. I mean, based on the police report, he's got a pretty sweet car that he has to give up for the season. So that's not nothing. He's got a 2019 Dodge Charger. So like, that would suck to have to give that up.
Yeah, the Bowen household doesn't have that.
neither does the Dupirak household. But don't get me wrong. He got really good parents. I think that needs to be pointed out. They're both military, so they don't mess around. So that is the end, apparently, of the Xavier Johnson saga. That's where that ends. Mike Woodson's really, really happy with, I guess, how he's performed, just as a player and as a person this offseason. So I think there's something to be said for that, I guess. I think Johnson, I talked to Johnson a little bit, but Zach really did more. And basically, you know, I said, hey, I really was concerned. I thought I might lose. Might just be done playing basketball after that. I wasn't sure how much trouble I was going to be in. I'm, really blessed to get lucky and, to be able to keep playing. And he certainly is. So was fortunate there. I guess the legal consequences are certainly not that overwhelming. It's 50 hours community service, which if he just gets that done in a year, then he avoids a 60-day suspended sentence. So he comes out of it in pretty decent shape, but obviously at least you would think is, scared enough. And you would think losing the car at least, gets him straightened out, but at least in this case, you don't have to worry about him, driving really fast anymore. So, at least in Bloomington for this year,
I'm happy if I have an iPhone charger. You know, I'm just content with that. I'm
just happy if the A bus was on time to pick me up from the Villas. You know, I'm like, gosh, let's just make sure I get to 3rd Street on time. Dustin, thank you for hopping on with us.
What's the doggie's name, Dustin?
It's Maxine.
Maxine. Give Maxine a pat for us.
I absolutely will. So she has calmed down now. Whatever the disturbance was, she feels like she's now mitigated.
Beagles were the 2007 Westminster Grand Prize winner. They've been very cocky ever since. You can look it up.
Yeah. She probably knows that intrintsically. She's aware, and that's why she
that's right.
She runs around town like this, acting like she owns a joint.
Dustin, safe travels to Lincoln, and thanks for coming on.
It sounds good. I'm not going, but...
No, well, you're there in spirit.
Let's hope Indiana does.
Dustin DePerak. Right there on the Payless Liquors hotline.
You know who won the Westminster Dog Show in 2007?
Why don't you look that up and see what you think? We do educate and entertain here, Mark.
How does your brain work?
It may be 08. It may be 08, but I'm confident that a Beagle won.
In the foundation.
I'm confident a Beagle won. Grand Prize. Best in show. Best in show, number one overall, whatever. At the Westminster Kennel Dog Show.
See, I'm looking up 2007 and 2008. 2007 was in...
See, my
English
worry.
Springer Spaniel.
Okay.
So that's incorrect.
2008.
My worry about naming Max is Dustin's dog is Maxine.
Which
Uno,
one?
Uno, a 15-inch beagle trotting out for Best in Show.
Come on.
Yeah,
come on.
This is when the dog won the show.
Yeah.
10 years ago.
10, it's 15 at this point.
There has to be somebody out there that's like, wait a minute, did Query really just pull off the top of his head that, and I had 2 years I gave you, but that one of those 2 years, a Beagle won, I was off by a year, sorry, that a Beagle won Westminster Best in Show. And come on.
Do you think they follow that up with, God, this guy's got to get a life?
That Beagle really showed that Boston Terrier what was up.
They're like, man, this guy that I listen to in the morning is incredible. How has this guy lasted a year? That's what they're saying to themselves, right?
My God.
I'm just telling you.
On the Westminster Dog Show route.
Speaking of dogs, not in the most complimentary manner, I was thinking about this after seeing the performance from the Washington Commanders on Sunday. Colts fans should make sure that they cheer for Carson Wentz to continue to be adequate this season. Remember, there's
a pick on the line.
There's a pick on the line. Trade stipulation of a second-round pick if Carson Wentz were to play 70% of the snaps in Washington, and that would fall to a third-rounder if he does not. So 70% would be right around like 12 or 13 games. So you want to make – I mean, and Carson Wentz, to be fair, had – nice first 2 weeks of the season. Not good in week three. But you don't want him to get benched or hurt.
Correct.
Colts fans, just keep an eye.
Hey, man, don't forget. That. When the Colts traded Jeff George to Atlanta, it was conditional in terms of their compensation back. Atlanta had to make the playoffs in order for the Colts to get Atlanta's first round pick in a subsequent later year. Final game of the regular season, Atlanta gets a last-second win. Jeff George lifts them to a playoff win. They go to the playoffs. Colts get the first-round pick. You know who they took? The Indianapolis Colts select wide receiver, Syracuse, Marvin Harrison.
Yeah, you think that mattered for the franchise?
So, yeah. You want those things to work out.
And remember,
right?
You traded your third-round pick for this coming draft in 2023. That was in the Nick Cross trade last year. So when you start to think about the future quarterback, how this quarterback class looks in 2023, the quarterback needy teams that are likely going to be drafting ahead of you, all of this stuff is pretty relevant. So
see which game your boy Spiro's doing this weekend, by the way. I was surprised. That's a pretty marquee game, I think.
Really? What are they having for?
Jaguars-Eagles. I think that's one of the more intriguing games of week four.
So I did see this note because a lot of people asked me, why did Romo and Nance do Colts-Chiefs and not Dolphins-Bills? Someone was saying that in the offseason, they map out the first 4 weeks of the year and they hand those to the broadcast crews.
Yeah, because Nance and Romo are doing Packers-Patriots this week, and you would not have put them in that game.
If you're making that decision right now,
you know that Mac Jones is going to be out. Yeah,
you would not have sent them there. So I think that's part of the reason why you saw Romo and Nance doing that game, not Bills Dolphins, and why Spiro all of a sudden gets a pretty good game. What's that line? Is it?
I want to say the Jaguars are like 6.5-point underdogs, I think. It might have dropped a little bit. I thought that's the last I checked was Jaguar or the Eagles were 6.5-point favorites. Let me check.
Does it look like Tua's going to give it a go tomorrow night?
I think so.
Man, that Dolphins defense, they played 90 plays on Sunday in the heat against Buffalo, Eagles, and now they're playing Thursday night.
Eagles 6.5-point favorites.
Oh, you get a couple Gatorades, you're good to go the next day.
Bengals 3.5-point
prime athletes, Kevin.
Against the Dolphins tomorrow night.
Say that again, Mark.
Bengals are 3.5-point favorites against the Dolphins tomorrow night.
Yeah, I think part of that is the old short week. Someone asked me on Twitter, are you guys not on Facebook anymore? Are you all not airing on Facebook anymore? Did we ever air on Facebook? I have no idea. YouTube, that's the stream.
YouTube, we're up. Twitter, we're up. I don't know about Facebook.
You can head to 107.5 The Fan on Twitter, and you can find the stream right there.
Facebook I usually only go to for, like, memories these days.
Excuse me?
When, like, a memory pops up. Like, I used memories from 5 years ago. Okay.
Yeah, that's cool. Occasionally will look at a birthday on there, but I'm not a big Facebook human.
Okay.
Do your high school friends get into heavy debates on Facebook?
No, I'm with you.
You stay clear?
Pretty much abstain, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like our Facebook is down.
You just glared at Scotty.
Scotty has arrived wearing a Lloyd Mosby jersey.
Is that a Beau Bichette jersey, Scotty?
No. Scotty is decked out in full Blue Jays gear.
That's
the old school awesome Blue Jays mid-80s.
Love that. Absolutely love that look. A five-for-fiver yesterday from Ryan on the pop quiz. We've never had two in 1 week. We'll see. Scotty, did you go with kind of the FU pop quiz?
No, I didn't.
Excuse me?
No?
I did not.
Okay.
I give it about a 6 or 7.
A little tamer. I feel like ever since Jake turned 50, you've been tamer with the pop quiz.
I also have, by the way, coming up after the pop quiz, I have for you guys Australian treats.
Oh, wow. Have I been looking forward to this all show?
Vegemite sandwich.
No. I did. Now I have Vegemite. But Michael couldn't make it in. He's got work to do. He's working hard on a Zoom or something in Australia.
Stuffed kangaroo.
So they gave me Daniela, which is Michael's significant other and Marcus's mother. These are the Australians I've been showing around all week. I'm like Judge Reinhold in Seinfeld. I'm taking them to Chicago today, and they said, well, here, we have treats for you. And so they brought me what I would say is a nice counterbalance to the Vegemite.
Okay.
And I'm telling you right now, when we do this on the air, both of you are, I am going to vault to the top of your Christmas gift list, because you're going to say, and then you're going to ask me for this for the rest of the year. Do you have any more? Do you have any more? That's what you're going to say.
Oh, you're not going to be throwing bits of honey at me at 7:05 in the morning every day?
You don't like it when I buy you the bit of honey at the gas station on the way here? I guess I just won't do that anymore.
One comes rocketing at my head. Like, hey, ghost, candy. I'm like, geez.
And to be fair, I mean, those are like 1 ounce away from a brick being thrown at your head.
Sometimes I get them when they're fresh.
Scotty, someone texted me curious about your age. Do you care to share? 5'8 for Scotty Johnston.
Scotty, a youngish 5'8, by the way.
Pop quiz coming up in about 5 minutes. 317-239-1070 on that front. Let's do a morning checkdown here.
The morning checkdown.
Omaha!
Brought to you by Ball State Football. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com.
Omaha!
On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Aaron Judge still sits on 60 home runs for the season. He had a lot of intentional walks yesterday. The Blue Jays, in which Scotty is wearing their jersey today, intentionally getting Aaron Judge on base on more than one occasion, but the Yanks win 5-2 elsewhere yesterday in Major League Baseball. Congratulations to the best fans in baseball. It is your knowledge of understanding when exactly a bunt is prudent that has allowed the St. Louis Cardinals to go to the postseason for the fourth straight year. They beat the Brewers 6-2. What was that?
That was a fart sound for the Cardinals.
Thought it was Dan Orlovsky for a second there.
Pirates over the Reds 4-1. Cubs over the Philadelphia Phillies yesterday 2-1. And the Indianapolis Indians losing to the Columbus Clippers 7-1.
We don't have a lot of great pennant races here to close out the year. NL East still up for grabs. That's really it. The wild cards aren't even filled with that much drama. Wasn't that the thought process in like expanding the playoffs? More teams would be in it late.
NL East would be the Braves, who defeated Washington 8-2, and the Mets over, who lost to the Marlins 6-4. Those are the two in play, right?
Yeah, that's all the other divisions are clinched.
You know, the Mets have that fun theme song. That's why I like them. Meet the Mets. Meet the Mets.
I thought you were talking about the intro music for the bullpen, the guy out of the bullpen.
They do have that too, but the Meet the Mets song's fun. Okay.
A lot of maturity there for Mark. The Pacers, their first training camp practice.
It's after nine, isn't it?
Yesterday. Here was Rick Carlisle afterwards on a very new-look bunch.
Kevin and Chad did a great job of making the right deals, turning the roster over.
Talking about
putting
me
us
there.
In a position to build around a great young point guard. A few months later, you know, we've got a lot of athletes, and we got a lot of guys that could do a lot of different things. So it can be a big learning process early. And really all the way through, but it's going to be a much different looking team.
Your guy put on some weight, Jake. I know you're over there at Pacers practice. Did Isaiah Jackson look a little thicker to you?
You know what? I didn't get a good look at him. I mean, I watched him from the opposite court at the very end of practice during the media avail, and I couldn't really tell on him. Now, Terry Taylor came over, and man, I'll tell you what, he is not a huge guy, but he is a nonstop energy guy. Terry Taylor, what are we doing here, Mark?
Camera out or something.
I didn't do anything to it. I've just been sitting here.
Looking up Westminster Dog Show fun facts.
No, that was you looking that up just to confirm what I already knew. Why would I look it up? I knew that the 2008 winner was a beagle. Why would I have
How
to look that up?
How were you supposed to swoosh when Mark's out of his chair?
Whoosh, there.
The new fart sound again. You want the fart sound?
No, we don't.
Colts, their first practice of the week is today. Injury-wise, again, Shaquille Leonard, that watch continues. He's practiced for, what is it now, 11 straight days, so I don't think it's necessarily, is he going to practice? It's more of, is he going to play on Sunday? Julian Blackman would be the one. He exited with an ankle injury. But when you talk about Tennessee, it's run first, and I would say both sides of the ball. Some stats that favor the Colts for this weekend. Derrick Henry's like in the 20s in yards per carry this year, and Tennessee is the worst rushing defense in the NFL.
The worst rushing defense?
The worst rushing defense in the NFL.
Good news for the Colts. They got a pretty good back.
Titans are wounded, very wounded. Interior of their D-line, though, from a pass rush standpoint, DeNico Autry and Jeffrey Simmons, that'll be something to keep an eye on with the Colts' recent struggles in pass protection.
Pop quiz up next. 239-1070 is the telephone number. What do we have on the line, Mark, in terms of
Jiffy
what's at
Lube
stake?
Oil change.
A Jiffy Lube oil change. Okay. So we will get you the Jiffy Lube oil change if you were to go 5 for 5. Pop quiz is next. Scotty Johnson's here. With his all Blue Jays gear on, is that a sign of what might be in the pop quiz? We'll find out, and we'll do it next. 239-1070. Kevin and Query, 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
Tavern Tour 22, brought to you by Evan Williams, continues Thursday at Coaches Downtown. Join J&V this Thursday from 3 to 6 p.m. for Great Wings and Evan Williams at Coaches on Pennsylvania Downtown. Tavern Tour 22.
Whether it's the news, the traffic, the weather, or your COVID-19 vaccinations, it's important to stay up to date. Sponsored by Pfizer and BioNTech.
Football is back, and so is your chance to win with BetRivers Sportsbook app. Featuring our new multi-game same-game parlay, combine the action of multiple same-game parlays in one bet for more action and bigger payouts. Bet the spread, bet the over, bet player props, and more. Throw in daily odds boost plus award-winning customer service, and it's a touchdown. Download it today.
Must be 21 plus. Available in Indiana only. Void where prohibited. Terms and conditions apply. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Do you have a travel bucket list? Maybe you want to run with the bulls in Spain. How about snorkel with the sharks in Bora Bora? No matter what you choose, AAA has you covered with their new AAA Adventure Trips. Let the AAA Travel Team help find the adventure that's right for you. Adventure awaits with AAA. Learn more at AAA.com/adventure. And before you pack your bags, make sure you don't leave home without your AAA membership. Flat tire, dead battery, run out of gas, lock your keys in the car. AAA is there 24/7, 365 days a year, no matter where your travels take you. So before you take off on your next adventure, do yourself a favor. Do what Lee and I did. Join AAA today. To get your AAA membership, visit AAA.com, call 844-GO-AAA-GO, or stop by your local AAA office. If you do, tell them Daniel J. Dockich sent you.
Hey, it's JMV for Aurora Specialty Sleep Clinic. Are you currently sleeping on the couch, fellas, right? Has she threatened to send you there because, you know, that snoring thing every single night? It's time to visit the Aurora Specialty Sleep Clinic. Aurora treats snoring and sleep apnea with custom-made mouthpieces that will keep you off the couch and keep her off your back. StopYourSnoreNow.com for a private consultation today. Aurora Specialty Sleep Clinic.
A new season, a new QB, a new look. Football is back. And so are Bud Light Blue Fridays. Every week, join JMV beginning at 3 for Cold Bud Lights, Colts football talk, and your chance to win tickets to Colts games.
Hey, it's JMV. Join me this Friday at Kilroy's downtown for your chance at Titans tickets.
JMV, Bud Light, and you, doing it for the shoe.
I'll see you this Friday at Kilroy's downtown.
The Ride with JMV.
You know, we thought this game against Kansas City was big, and don't get me wrong, it was as the first win of the season. But when you think about the Titans coming in here, and in the offseason, Jim Irsay talking about how important it is to beat the Titans, and knowing you have a loss and a tie within the division, biggest game of the year so far on Sunday.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Query. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
Very doable. Very, very doable.
Is it all baseball?
No. Really
doable.
I
saw a good amount of baseball on there.
This is very doable. It's time for the Pop Quiz with a Jiffy Lube oil change on the line. You know the rules. You simply answer all five questions correctly, and there you go. You get the oil change from Jiffy Lube, who, by the way, is committed, dedicated to helping out those around Indiana who use their vehicles to help out others. That's why you can nominate a Hoosier hero at JiffyLube.com/Indiana or JiffyLubeIndiana.com. Nominate somebody who uses their vehicle to help out. Meals on Wheels, for example, a great example of exactly that. And if they are selected, they will receive automobile maintenance for a year from Jiffy Lube of Indiana.
I love that.
Great organization. Mark, we have callers lined up.
Yes, we do.
Kevin, are you picking the number today?
Sure. Number 1 through 8. This is what, week 4 of the NFL? Let's go with number 4.
Jason.
Jason, what's up?
Yo.
Jason, have you called the program before?
I have not.
You have not? Okay. Can we play? We have a little game we do sometimes called Get to Know Your Listener. It's wildly popular. We have a lot of great success with it. Can we get, or are you willing to participate?
Yes, sir.
Jason, how old a fella are you?
I'm 42.
42-year-old Jason, okay. And Jason, if my math is correct, that would mean that you graduated from high school somewhere around 99 or 2000, is that right?
Yeah, 99.
Okay, and that would be from what school?
That would be Ben Davis High School, the Giants.
Okay, well, we'll speak slowly.
You know Brad Bowen?
Who's that?
You know Brad Bowen? Where'd you go to junior high?
Fulton.
Fulton, my dad taught PE and health there.
Okay, yeah.
Ring a bell or no?
Mr. Bowen, yes
or
no?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Was he a disciplinarian type?
I don't believe so.
Yeah, he's got a loud whistle. That was, I think, kind of his go-to thing.
Really?
He can do the fingers in the mouth whistle.
Okay.
I can never do that.
I know. I struggle with it.
Lastly, Jason, what line of work are you in today here in 2022?
I do utility work for Citizens Energy Group.
Oh, that's cool.
Okay. What line of work were you in 2007?
He was watching Beagles. Yeah. When the Westminster.
That's just a weird. What line of work are you in 2022? Well, what line of work are you in?
Well, I just meant today, in today's world. Mark, work with me here, would you?
Jason, right. We've never had 2 5-for-5s in a week.
I'm not a huge baseball guy, so this might be a little bit of a challenge.
Okay.
All right,
here we go. Well, just the first couple might be a little rough. Would you like for me, that would be Jake or Kevin, to lead you off?
Let's go with Kevin.
Okay.
All right, Ben Davis, Giant Pride right here on the line. Number 1, with the New York Yankees and the St. Louis Cardinals wrapping up division titles last night. Only one division championship remains up for grabs. We mentioned this in the last segment. Which division has not been decided?
I'll give you a hint. It's not in the American League, and it's not West.
Not in American League, not West. Let's go. I don't know.
Well, it's either the Central or the East.
Yeah, let's go with Central.
Can you name the league?
God, maybe my dad didn't teach very well.
American.
It's not American. Can you name the league? It's not in the American League.
National League.
Okay.
What the hell?
All right. Question number two, Jason. The Yankees clinched the AL East for the 20th time in franchise history. Since the divisional era began in 1969, only one franchise, which there's no way in hell after question number one you're going to know, has won its division more times. Name the franchise that began in Milwaukee and Dale Murphy played there and Hank Aaron played there and they're on TBS an awful lot and David Justice played there and Chipper Jones played there. What's that?
Let's go with the Braves.
Okay, Braves.
Boy, talk about a 180 in confidence there from 1 to 2. Number 3, Jason, the Dolphins will try to improve to 4-0 for the first time since 95 when they face the Bengals in Cincinnati on Thursday Night Football. Who did the Dolphins beat to improve to 4-0 in 1995? Cincinnati, the Colts, the Patriots, or the Jets?
Let's go with Cincinnati.
Question 4. Today marks the anniversary of the NFL record for most passing yards in a game. The quarterback who holds the record for most passing yards in a game at 554 is A, Matt Schaub, B, Norm Van Brocklin, C, Warren Moon, or D, Joe Burrow?
Let's go with Joe Burrow.
Okay.
To close things out here, Jason, on this day in 1919, the fastest game in Major League history took place with the Giants beating the Phillies 6-1. Within 10 minutes, how long did the game take?
That's the fastest game in history?
Yeah, fastest game. Mm-hmm.
Let's go with 1 hour, 20 minutes.
Not bad. Not right, but not bad. I'm just saying.
So 1 hour, 20 minutes, that is what, 80 minutes?
Imagine going to that game and like, I need to get some nachos. Like, what do you mean? It's the eighth inning already.
That's right.
Beer sales are gone after, 20 minutes there.
Okay, the National League East between the Braves and Mets, is the division still in play? Speaking of the Braves, they were the franchise that was the answer for number two, the only franchise to have won the division more times in the last 20 years than, or since 1969, than the Yankees. Bengals was correct for question number three, and then Norm Van Brocklin and 51 minutes to round things out. I've got Australian snacks for you guys that you're going to love. You're going to love. You don't seem confident. You don't seem happy.
I'm not confident in my love.
Well, your last Australian surprise was...
Mm-hmm. Right. Was one to forget.
Well, would you like to... Scotty, would you like to wager on whether or not the boys like what I brought from Down Under? Or well, rather
please
what...
Please phrase that better.
What Michael and Daniela and Marcus
God
brought?
Almighty.
Boy, I think I have a doctor's appointment actually here at 10 a.m., so you guys might need to handle this final segment by yourselves. We'll do it one final time here. Kevin Aquari, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Hi, I'm Emmitt Smith, Hall of Famer and all-time leading rusher with exciting news.
If you suffer from chronic joint pain, Emmitt Smith wants to introduce you to QC Kinetics.
QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in biologic treatment for pain. I'm talking regenerative solutions that encourage your body to heal and repair itself. No medications, no surgeries, no downtime.
If you have pain in your knees, hips, lower back, and shoulders, don't assume the old treatments are the only treatments. Learn more about how you can get lasting relief with biologic treatments that can repair and restore damaged tissue.
Call to learn more about this exciting natural way to deal with chronic joint pain. Play golf without pain. Walk upstairs without pain. Play with your kids and grandkids without pain. Get back on your job without pain. Live your life pain-free. Call QC Kinetics.
Call QC Kinetics, 463-235-7160. That's 463-235-7160. In Eagle Creek and Greenwood, 463-235-7160.
Hey there, Jake Query for BullseyeEventGroup.com. Colts Titans coming up this weekend. You want tickets to the game? No problem. BullseyeEventGroup.com. Would you like to experience the very best in terms of pregame tailgating with the best food, the best entertainment, the best drinks, and right there next to the stadium? Yes, sirree. BullseyeEventGroup.com is your answer for the ultimate VIP tailgating experience. Are there concerts that are coming into town or entertainment things that you would like to participate in? You're thinking about event tickets. No problem. BullseyeEventGroup.com. Do you like supporting a woman-owned, minority-owned business? Yes, BullseyeEventGroup.com has you covered there too. The best that you're going to find in terms of Colts pregame tailgating, the best food, the best drink, the best entertainment, right there in the shadows of Lucas Oil Stadium. Check it out, BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Verizon Connect has a new AI dash cam with dual cameras. It's sleek, simple, and easy to install. Oh, and did I mention, it's AI smart. It'll give your team real-time alerts.
Tailgating.
And each video is automatically classified and sent to your team, giving you context to help coach your drivers. Best yet, it seamlessly works in one platform that tracks your vehicles, dispatches jobs, and much more. See how Verizon Connect can help manage your fleet at verizonconnect.com/radio.
Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query. Football season is underway, so now's the perfect time to download FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Because right now, new customers of FanDuel get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. That's free bets back if your first bet doesn't win. All you have to do is sign up with promo code MARK. All on an app that's safe, secure, and easy to use. They have everyday odds, boosts, and specials. You get paid quickly when you try to withdraw, and you can combine your favorite bets in a same-game parlay to make your payouts even bigger. Lots of big matchups in Week 4. Colts and Titans, obviously, we're all over that one. Bills and Ravens, Dolphins against the Bengals on Thursday night. Plenty of big matchups going on, so choose your bet, and you'll get a no-sweat bet. Good for up to $1,000, a no-sweat first bet. Again, sign up with promo code MARK. Promo code MARK, M-A-R-C, exclusively on the FanDuel Sportsbook app. Make every moment more this season with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. Refund issued is now a drawable free bets. They expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
The Pacers open up the preseason in Charlotte against the Hornets Wednesday evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
I said, do you speak my language? He just smiled and gave me a Vegemite sandwich. And he said, I come from a land, land, land.
It's Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Colin Hay, who is the lead singer of Men at Work, he moved to Melbourne from Scotland when he was a boy, but grew up in Melbourne, Australia. And those of you who listen to this program know that over the last few days, I've been touring around my Australian friends who have become almost like family to me, Michael, Marcus, and Daniela, who are natives of Melbourne. I met them in a Pacer game several years ago. Michael and Marcus are diehard Pacer fans. They came back to the U.S., actually back to North America. They're going to a wedding in Toronto later in the week. So they came through Indianapolis first because they have a connection to the city based on the Pacers. So last night we went to my mom and dad's house to have some orange fluff cake from Taylor Bakery. And Daniela was nice enough to bring me snacks from Australia. These are, I don't know how you would, what is a snack or candy that is a U.S. custom that like everyone loves?
Reese's.
Okay. Peanut butter cups. So these are similar, I guess you'd say. You guys,
that's
did
high
not
praise.
Like, I brought you Vegemite and you did not like Vegemite, correct?
I thought it was horrible.
Yeah, it had a. My palate rejected it.
They did bring me Vegemite too. Do you guys want some?
And let me be clear, Jake. In no way, shape, or form do I want this to sound offensive to your friends. I think it's awesome that they're here. Frankly, I think it's really cool. It's a little side note. I think it's really cool. Like, there's two or three Pacers broadcasts a year where I'm like, JJ is interviewing a fan from Taiwan from, you know, South
crazy,
Africa. I'm like, wow, this is really cool. Yeah. These diehard Pacers fans exist all over the world.
So these are Tim Tams. Anybody who has been to Australia or knows of their food knows about Tim Tams. Now, they taste kind of, well, I don't know how else to describe it. They are listed in Australia as chocolate biscuits. But what you're supposed to do is bite off each end and then use them in milk and use them like a straw, kind of like the fella did with the hot dog at the Yankee game with beer. Now,
I wish I forgot that.
We don't have milk here, so you're not going to be able to do that. But here you go. Mark, there's your Tim Tam. Kevin, there's your Tim Tam.
Look at this.
See what you think. These are, there's a, there's a Nabisco cookie that they taste kind of like.
Should I save this and hand it out on Halloween, or should I be selfish?
No, you don't want to do that. Okay. Scotty, I can bring you one tomorrow if you'd like. I brought a whole bag of them. We'll see what
you think
here.
Showing the YouTube camera audience just the look of it.
So you're supposed to bite into the end of it and use it as a straw?
Well, if you had milk here, you because it's kind of hollow in the middle.
Okay.
That's what you're supposed to do is bite each end, and then it becomes a straw, and you take the milk through it. But obviously, you don't have the milk here.
I'll tell you what.
Kevin has had his first bite.
I'll tell you what,
of the Tim Tam.
I don't know if I agree with you on a lot of things, but I'm nodding my head at this one.
These are solid.
Mark, your thoughts?
Yep. 10 out of 10.
How would you describe the Tim Tam?
A little wafer-like on the inside.
Uh-huh.
The chocolate is tremendous. 10 out of 10. Mark's just handing out grades. I'd give it a solid 9.6. If a Reese's is 9.8, I'm putting a 9.6 on it.
Well, 10 out of 10, I'm using the metric system.
No. Excuse me. You and Jake just so fluent in your math these days.
So you approve, Mark?
Yeah. Now, anywhere in the States or no?
I think you can now, but for a long time, you could not buy them at all in the States, Tim Tams. I think these days, between Amazon and everything else, you can buy anything anywhere, right? I don't know that they're the pure, like, Australian, you know, a lot of those places, they use, like, a pure cane sugar, you know, whatever it might be. So I don't know if it's 100% off. These are obviously authentically Australian because Daniela brought them straight over.
Daniela, thank you.
Yes, so there
thank you
go.
Very much.
Jake, thank you. That was terrific.
They're pretty good, aren't they?
Can I have that for breakfast every day?
They are pretty good, man. Now, I did bring you. I didn't want you to feel.
Wait, there's more?
Well, yeah. You can take these home to the kids. Oh, Scotty, would you like a? I have gifts
Jake,
here.
I don't know if Max is going to be consuming Vegemite anytime soon.
Huh?
Is that what you're bringing out?
No, of course not. Give me more credit than that. What do you have on schedule for the rest of the day, Kev?
Heading up to Colts practice after this, first practice of the week. Wednesday is kind of my busy day. Back here to record a podcast a little bit later.
Fair enough.
You got anything?
I got tutoring tomorrow. I am driving the Australians to Chicago today. We are going to see Michael Jackson's home, childhood home. They want to see that on the way. No. There you go.
What do we got here? Vegemite. I mean, just look at the color of it on the back.
You know what it kind of looks like is black tar heroin.
I mean, just horrific.
Getting the veins ready.
Right. I do not want that.
What? Excuse me?
Now, what does this taste with, like, a Tim Tam? Does the Tim Tam, should I ruin my experience?
Excellent question. Go ahead and try.
I'll be the show monkey, sure.
Is there a...
I'll be the show monkey, says Mark has the Vegemite. And is.
Oh, God, I'm getting PTSD just smelling this thing.
Mark.
Mark is going to try the Vegemite. It's wonderful. It's a popular delicacy, a Vegemite sandwich.
Okay.
So this is, again, a yeast extract spread, I believe is what they call it. Mark has put Vegemite on the Tim.
That was a horrible mistake.
Mark.
It's a horrible mistake.
I'd like to say that I told you so.
Mark just
guzzles his water.
Did you put the Vegemite on the Tim Tam?
Yeah. Tim Tam lost in that respect.
Now, speaking of overseas, we've got the first London game this weekend.
Yes.
Saints and who, Scotty? It
doesn't stop.
Mark just turned around towards the trash can.
I don't want to be rude with your gifts, but that's going straight in the garbage.
Is this the 37th straight game that we've had in London where neither team's above 500?
This is Saints and Vikings, you said?
Vikings and Saints, yeah.
There is some discussion, is there not? Correct me if I'm wrong here.
Kirk Cousins and Jameis Winston. Nothing says let's honor the queen like sending those two over.
Am I correct in saying that there has been discussion that because New Orleans and Minnesota have vacated, you know, have left to go to London, that if need be, if Tampa needs to be rescheduled, they could, or Tampa needs to be moved, the Bucs game could be moved to New Orleans or Minneapolis, correct?
Oh, that would make some sense.
I thought I heard that.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, there would be teams all over the place that are on the road, but I mean.
And as we said earlier, the Bucs are training down at the Dolphins facility. It's very unique that, you know, you have this Hurricane Ian and it's heading towards that St. Pete, Tampa area, and kind of on that diagonal, northeast diagonal through the state of Florida and the southern part, Miami, the Keys down there. They seem to be in the clear And I say that in quotes. So with the Dolphins playing on Thursday Night Football this week, their facility is open and looks like Tampa Bay is down there for that.
You know, the whole thing is fascinating with the hurricane. I mean, so many people in this area have obviously friends and family in throughout Florida, you know. I know everybody is concerned. My cousin lives in, you know, St. Pete, and my family's in St. Pete or Tampa. She actually lives in Tampa, but is from St. Pete. So, you know, there are, but it looks like now it might be going down just to the south of that, right? In terms of the main epicenter landfall.
I was seeing like a split of kind of Fort Myers and St. Pete, like in between those two.
Yeah.
Obviously could be wrong on that, but that was the latest projection I saw. Mark, David's been hanging on. Want to talk a little Myles Turner?
Yeah.
David, you hear a Myles Turner talk earlier?
Yes. Hi, guys. Good morning to you. I was just confused about, I was reading on Bob Kravitz's article on Athletic last night saying Myles Turner's J's are numbered, and I remember listening in when you guys were talking to Chad Buchanan, and he said we're keeping him in the year, and he decided to finally have the five spot. Is this just another rumor, or should we pay more attention to Bob Kravitz's article?
Okay, good question, David.
Sounded
and I
like he was down under.
That's right. He was underneath Vegemite himself. David, listen, I love Bob, and I got a ton of respect for Bob, and I don't have any doubt about the fact that Bob Kravitz is as tied in as anybody. Is Myles Turner ultimately somebody that the Pacers could shop? Yes, I think that is probably very possible. Is it somebody that they're going to shop imminently in the next week or so? I don't personally believe that's the case. I could be totally wrong. I could be totally wrong, but I think they are right now content with and proceeding as if they're not going to make a trade. Now, you know, what I was told was, hey, listen, we always reserve the right to change our mind, basically. But that right now, things appear as though that's where they're going in terms of keeping status quo.
Guys, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the wording I said to Chad Buchanan last Wednesday at the Pacers golf outing was, do you expect Myles Turner to be your center on opening night? And he answered yes. Well, I mean, you don't typically see trades a week or two before the start of the season. I think the bigger question, and Bob alluded to this throughout that article, is this relationship he does not believe will last past this season. And I think it's really key to point out, relationship, two-way street. This is not necessarily the Pacers saying, we want no part of Myles Turner moving forward. It's Myles Turner, I think, realizing that at the age of 26 years old, this is the last time to truly cash in. He's never been an unrestricted free agent. So if indeed he is still a Pacer at the end of this year, I would think given of everything that's happened, he probably would explore some options.
It really is fascinating though, Kevin, because if you're trying to, the catch 22 for Indiana is this: if you're trying to use Myles Turner to flip him into a future pick or another young player, then you've got to, even though I think people know at this point what Myles Turner can do, but because he's coming off injury, you want to be able to showcase that they are still getting a viable product.
Right.
But the longer that you try to showcase him, the more you're holding back the guys you have currently on your roster. So it is a tricky area, but he's also only 26.
And he's never played with Tyrese Halliburton. Is there any intrigue Correct. There of what he could look like? He's never been the solo big. Again, it's fascinating is the exact way to describe this situation. And to a lesser extent, Jake, you can make the same sort of cases for, you know, Buddy Hield with Benedict Mathurin or Chris Duarte, you know, Daniel Tice with Isaiah Jackson. We talked about it yesterday. TJ McConnell with Andrew Nembhard. All these high-paid Pacers that are getting up there in age, and the other guys that I mentioned are older than Turner. If you play them, you're also stunting some young growth. And who are the pieces that you want here in 2023, 2024, and beyond?
Right. They
be an interesting juggle to watch Rick Carlisle all year long.
Again, yesterday was a short practice for the Pacers. We'll see, you know, what they decide to do in terms of how they're going out there. But
Tiny Tim Tam was outstanding. The Vegemite. Do you want it back?
Sure. I'll give it to Mark. Mark Vegemite?
I think there's a reason why Mark hasn't spoken since he first consumed the Vegemite.
Scraping my palate as we speak.
Colts first practice of the week is today. We will chat about that tomorrow, and we'll get a little look at Purdue. It's a big one for Purdue at Minnesota. They are a 10-point underdog. The Aiden O'Connell injury, not ideal. We'll chat about that tomorrow. Everybody have a great day. We'll see you.